Hello.
Yo, how goes it?
Good.
Let's see. There we go. Right, do me a favor and say something for us.
Hello.
Okay, let me turn myself up slightly and that should help. Right, now I got music in the background going. And got my dice. Do I have a calculator though? I do. Does the other one work still?
Hello.
Yo. What's going on?
Good, nothing much.
Good to hear. Alright. So that's ready to go. Let me grab out the other calculator. Perfect. Ugh. Are you ready for an interesting session today?
Mm-hmm.
Be prepared. I've got something unique planned. Not gonna lie, taking that rest was probably your best bet. Oh, man. Let's see if the other guys will show up. So what have you been up to, Fraz?
Nothing really.
Fair enough. You planning on doing anything interesting in the future?
Nope.
Is there anything interesting going on in your life whatsoever?
None.
God damn it, Fraz. You're making this difficult.
Yes, I am.
Why?
No reason.
I feel like you're just doing this to annoy me. Let's see. There we go. Well, whatever. Now I'll move on from the subject. How goes work, by the way?
It's simple enough.
God damn it, Fraz, be a conversationalist. Fuck's sake. You're an asshole, man.
Maybe.
I'm trying to make this entertaining, you know, give the people something to listen to, and all you're doing is making this more of a pain in the ass.
I'm not apologizing.
God damn it, Fraz. No. Oops, let me get over in center frame. There we go. Okay, cool. Well, today or tomorrow will be my last bulking day, which is gonna suck, because Monday that means I'm back in the gym. Hitting heavy weight, eating better, and yeah, five to 6 days a week I'll be at the gym, and then coming home and doing philosophy homework. So, oh man,
bless you.
Thank you. Ah, gods.
And hello,
yo, Wolf. What's going on, man?
What's up?
That's what I asked you.
Yeah, but I asked you second.
God damn it, Wolf. Enjoying being unemployed?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a dream.
Nothing to do. All that free time on your hands?
I'm actually in Seattle right now.
Oh, sounds fun. Who are you bothering up there?
Some friends.
What's just her name?
Katie.
She cute?
Yeah.
And that's what matters.
The second wheel in the tricycle.
Oh, that's fucked up. Oh.
Is it though?
Yeah. I mean, damn, man. The fuck? What happened? Okay, you're gonna have to eventually explain to me, like, what ended up happening between you and the previous one. I'm not gonna name names just out of respect. At least give me an idea.
Well, just did, though.
Well, he named his new the new girlfriend. Well, new
no.
fun, new buddy, I guess. Oh my god, that's gods. Well, I've had enough food today and coffee that I'm raring to go. Tonight's session's gonna be very entertaining. So, I just had a stack of 7 pancakes, 3 eggs, and 2 whole sausages, so.
I got to play D&D in person with a few buddies last night.
Oh yeah? They half as good of a DM, or you have half as good of a DM as me?
Better.
Ouch.
And it was her first time.
Now,
extra.
Let me ask the question here.
Go for it.
When you say first time, you mean DMing, or? Because that could really, I can't help you out in that certain categories.
The last letter of D&D definitely applies.
Oh, I don't need advice from you about that subject.
Well, no, not that I'm saying you need advice. I'm saying, well, don't mention that one either. I'm saying that if she was performing things well beyond the requirement of the Dungeon Master, then I can't compete with that. That's not fair. And nor do I plan to. Oh, man. Notice he's not denying it. fair enough, man. Is this...
Look,
yeah?
I get bribe points in your game. I get bribe points in hers.
I bet you do. But they're earned 2 different ways, just to clarify for those people on stream. He just buys me shit. I'm a cheap whore. So...
You're a gold digging whore is what you are.
Pretty much.
He's just a poor whore.
You know, I don't put out, but I do take your gifts. And, Wolf, I am so working out while listening to this dead book. Oh my fucking god. It is the darkest book I've ever listened to.
I'm disowning you.
Dude, I already listen to motivational speeches when I work out.
You're...
One of those. Dude, I don't listen to music. Like, I put in my headphones and I listen to motivational speeches on Spotify.
That's mind-boggling.
I don't know. Music doesn't do anything for me. That's the problem. So, like, unless I'm running. If I'm running, then yeah, music's great because it basically distracts my mind. But and listening to motivational speeches has me thinking. But I like the constant encouragement I get from the listening to the speech. So, I don't know. It's just how I am. But I'm also the same guy who will sleep with headphones in and listen to a book while I cry asleep. So.
While you cry?
No, while I sleep, not while I cry.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't... While I sleep.
Oh. No. Well, I mean, I'm in the restroom as well, but, you know. Yes, I've been crying myself to sleep. It's, you know, so sad. I've been so lonely here.
I know you miss me.
No. No.
Yeah.
I can honestly say no to that one.
Okay. I'm coming a couple days from now.
Yeah, you're coming over on Monday to get stuff after I get off from work. I'll probably be doing philosophy homework. You'll get to see me crying over a textbook. That'll be entertaining. Because this is the most boring... It's like... The best way I can explain it is if you imagine taking a brand new person, making them Dungeon Master, and then putting in a bunch of extremely elaborate vocabulary, but not knowing any of what it means. That's what this book is. The person uses very fancy words that they don't seem to have a full understanding of.
Yeah, not gonna lie.
Mm-hmm.
I totally zoned you out right there.
Wow. Not surprised. Half of my D&D campaign.
I've been zoning out for a lot longer.
Fuck you both, alright? You know what? I quit! Fraz is the new DM.
Listen when it's time for the game, okay? Not the pre-stream.
Fraz is the new DM. Fuck you all.
So, do you guys want to continue? Yes, just send me your thing and then we'll...
I'm not giving you any of my shit. Fuck you.
No, character sheet if you want to play.
Oh, and I managed to get myself killed in another in a friend of mine's campaign, so... Which was fun. Apparently pissing on the king's boots as a barbarian wasn't my best idea. Especially at level 2. Oh, fun times. Alright, fuck you both. Okay, I'm gonna go back to listening to music.
What? No, dude, I'm listening.
Yeah, sure. Mm-hmm.
You pissed on King's boots. Genius.
Get some pump-up music going. It'll get me a bunch of YouTube copyright strikes, but I don't give a shit anymore. I'm gonna be honest. Ugh. Nope. It was so. This is fun. YouTube gave me a copyright strike for a game I was playing for the soundtrack in the game. No joke. And it wasn't like some fancy song. It was literally just instrumental music in the background.
Welcome to YouTube.
Well, I'm like, I don't make money off YouTube. Hell, I don't make money off Twitch. But it's still stupid. I mean, ugh. Also, I love the fact, Cameron, I don't know if you're watching this, but if you are, I apologize ahead of time. I'm talking a shit about this. The fact that he thinks he's going to make money, enough money to pay for his internet bill off of his first stream is extremely
unlikely
is a good word for it.
Impossible?
Yeah, would be a better word for it. I mean, even someone, for example, in recent Twitch news, we shall not say the name that shall not be mentioned here, Ninja, who moved over to Mixer, lost like a good half his fan base when he moved over. And so, I don't know how a guy expects on his like first stream to actually be able to make any money off of it, you know, when he's never streamed before. I mean, I've been streaming for now almost a full year. And still have it. Actually, I've been streaming for over a full year now. And still have it made more than I think most in a day, $15. So, and Twitch took all that fucking money, fucking assholes. But yeah, I don't know. Wolf, are you driving?
No.
Oh, okay. So you're just hanging out in Seattle for the day.
No, I came up last night, chilling here today, and,
sure did
camp
come up
tonight.
Oh, so, where are you at?
Just outside of Seattle.
Oh, okay.
And, head back into Seattle tomorrow,
mm-hmm.
and do a few more things, then head home.
Fair enough. Alright.
Finish packing, and,
get ready to leave.
I'm out. Yeah, Monday night, I'm out.
Jesus, can't believe it. We're losing the Wolf, I'll be the only one on the West Coast from here on out.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna be real lonely. Oh, man. What am I gonna do? I guess they'll give me, 9 months to work out every day of the week, and when you come back, basically come and bench press you.
I mean, you should be able to.
That sounds like a decision.
In a year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's the goal. Is I'm spending my entire senior year, I'm going to hit the gym every day of the week minus Sundays. Because Sundays are... What?
Let me stop you right there.
What?
Because you've said multiple times, I'm going to start going 6 days a week. And then you
and I did. That. No, I did for a full week. The problem was it was right before... Or it was the week before the max problem hit where we lost our max between Lloyd and the Rose Center. And now it takes 2 to 3 hours to get to downtown that I just decide, no, fuck this. I'm not going to go for the next 2 weeks. I'm going to spend, well, I went the first week every day, except for Saturday, because I went hiking last Saturday. And then this week I didn't go because I decided just to bulk up because the max was even getting even worse to go down there because they were slowing down the train around Hollywood and making it take almost another half an hour on top of that. So, no, I start back up Monday. Like, I'm fully dedicated to do that. Thank you very much.
Sure.
I need to work on my arms.
All I hear are excuses, but okay.
Hey, you know what? When you come back up here and you see I'm twice the size as I was, you know, you can fucking eat those words, man.
Oh, am I?
I may not be able to outlift you, but I will get twice, at least twice as big as I am.
I already have a gym picked out.
Good.
In Ohio.
That was the first thing you did, wasn't it, when planning the trip?
Yep, picked it out before I picked out where I'm
going. So, did you get fired or did you just quit?
What?
Did you get fired or did you just quit the job? Or is it vacation?
Oh, I quit.
Oh.
Because I'm moving.
Well, he's not moving, he's heading out there for a few months.
I'm moving. Because I'm not coming back.
What?
Where I was living before.
You're not coming back to Washington?
I'd probably come back to the Northwest.
Oh, okay.
Washington, maybe Oregon, but I'm not coming back to where I was living before.
So I wouldn't want to stay out in Ohio. I mean, don't get me wrong,
great state,
but there's nothing to do there.
Yeah, no, it's not a great state. It's pointless.
I mean, if you're in the Air Force, it's great. I mean, there's a nice base there, and it's a great place to chill, but you're a little big to join the military, Wolf, so...
Oh, yeah. In high school, I went, like, they have the day where the recruiters come and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And a bunch of our class, like, the seniors went up and started doing, like, the pull-up and push-up challenges and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I started cranking them out, and I got, I can't do many pull-ups.
Mm-hmm.
I got, like, 14.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I got, like, 50-some-odd push-ups at the time, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Before I just stopped. Because they were like, yeah, you're kind of big.
Yeah, they're not going to find a uniform for you, man. That's the problem. I mean, I had a friend of mine when I was in high school. Now, this was before the pull-up test was part of the requirement to enlist. This is when it was just push-ups, sit-ups, and then the run. His name was Johnny, and I won't go with his last name, but he was a Romanian kid. Big motherfucker. He's 6'4", about 280, I'd say, and he broke the record at our school for squats. I can't remember how much it was, but I know he could have been a fucking powerlifter, a professional powerlifter. He was just a big dude, and he was the biggest teddy bear I ever met. He goes to take the test, because me and him were both going to enlist around the same time. And we had the same recruiter when I was trying to enlist. Of course, this is when I found out I couldn't join due to my double felony. But he goes in, and the recruiter looks at me and is like, I'm not going to lie, you're flat-footed, and the fact is we don't have uniforms in your size. And he looks at me and he's like, just take two of them and sew them together. And the recruiter's like, no, that's... because when you get to a certain... If you're born, I guess... A lot of bigger guys that typically do a lot of weight training and who are naturally born larger end up flat-footed really quickly because their feet have to take on so much weight. So I don't know if he was actually flat-footed or if he just ran flat-footed. Like, the main thing is you can't join the American military if you run flat-footed. Because then you can't carry, there's certain amounts of equipment you can't carry, which I don't get, because if you're at the point where you're 6'4", and you can bench press, I think he was doing, 250 pounds at the time, I can't remember how much his actual bench was, it was a while ago, given this was, Shit, back before 2012. I'm not going to do the math there. And yeah, so he, the guy could live. I mean, there's nothing he couldn't lift in the military. I mean, he could have probably picked up artillery at this point and gone running into battle with it. That was their whole joke. But nope, they wouldn't let him enlist because of the fact that he was just too big and they had no need for the soldiers. So it's like, all right. And I don't know what he ended up doing. I know his parents owned a butcher shop, but I can't remember where out at. But yeah, dude was fucking huge. And Wolf, I'd say that although you're shorter than him, your like width is about the same. So
he's probably out there being serial killer.
Dude, we always thought he was an enforcer for the fucking mob when we saw this kid. Like, and he had a name that just kind of, not just being named Johnny, but his last name was fucking terrifying as well, because it was a very rough and very Russian name, very Slavic name.
He was going to be Russian.
We thought he was Russian until he mentioned, until he brought in these, like, weird tomato things that were really sweet. I can't remember what the fuck they're called.
What, did they say they were,
Romanian something. They were, I can't remember what the fuck they're called, but it's just like, it looks like a tomato, but you bite into it like it's like an apple, and it's very sweet. I want to say it's called a Romanian tomato, but I know that's not right. I'll have to look it up later. Anyways, yeah, but that's how we found out he's Romanian, because he's like, oh yeah, these are from my home country. My mother just got back from our old home where my grandparents live and brought these with her. I'm like, how the fuck did she get that through customs? You just don't ask questions like that, though. Where the fuck? Okay.
Romanian raspberry?
I'll have to look it up. I don't know if Robert's gonna be here, but he might be. Because Robert's got a, what's it fucking called? Playoffs for his team.
That's fair. He's like a coach, right?
Yeah.
Is it a middle school or a college one?
I think he's middle school and high school, isn't that right, Wolf?
Who?
Robert.
I think he does one middle school and there's one semi-pro team that he
coaches. Oh, so which one's the playoffs? The middle school or the semi-pro?
Middle school. But yeah, jeez though, it's still a wonder that the fact that, you know, Wolf, that you're so young, that difference in age group, that you were part of the group that couldn't enlist without doing the pull-up test. I would have fucking died. I don't think I've ever actually been able to do more than 2 pull-ups in my entire life. I think that's my record. I'm gonna be honest.
I was like super proud that I got like 14. My buddies were getting like 20, 30, 40.
Jesus!
I got 14. Yeah.
Well, it's really an advantage to be kind of thin and like lightly muscled for that shit.
Oh yeah.
I mean, ugh.
I'm a thick boy. I have a lot of weight.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's like, as you get heavier, I mean, I was watching Martin Lisi's do this, and I think that's one of the reasons why he's able to beat the strongman's this last competitions. It's just because of the fact that he's fucking athletic as shit. So, by the way, Eddie Hall took Britain's strongest man competition this year and is going on to Worlds again. So, we're going to...
I should go to the gym.
You should.
By day, because I literally have no money.
Well, think about it, Fraz. If you start hitting up a gym, man, once you get yourself a nice membership and everything, well, once you get into college, there's most likely you'll be able to go to the gym there. Then you can come hang out with me and Wolf when we decide to go compete in competitions and such.
I'm probably just going to beat you guys in legs, and that's it.
Wait, say that again?
I'm just going to beat you guys in legs.
Well, I don't know. Wolf's got really strong legs.
I do. I have thunder thighs.
I mean,
like I.
Go ahead.
End up splitting pants when I squat because they just get a fucking pump into half.
Basketball shorts, man.
I can't wear pants to the gym. They just split in like four different.
Who wears pants to the gym?
Well, like sweatpants and such, dude.
Okay, because I was thinking jeans. Yeah.
No, not like jeans. You can't squat in jeans.
I know, I tried it.
Well, I know some girls who can, but
like super, super baggy sweatpants just to.
That's when you know you can do good weight. Worse. Yeah.
Hold on, something real quick.
No worries. No, I'm starting to get back into leg day. We started doing, or at the house, I've started doing squats out in my backyard and doing non-weighted squats. I'm up to 50 without stopping now, which is nice. And then doing high elevation climbs for hikes have been really working well on my legs. So, but I'm thinking what I'm going to do when I get, once I get my own place next year, because I'm actually looking at buying a house by the time I'm, by the end of next summer. Since I found some cool little loopholes for being an Oregonian, I'm going to try and get a big one of them 800 pound tires, and I'm going to put that in my backyard and just throw that around and use that to work on legs, because the squat rack still is so unbalanced for me. But no, I was watching Eddie Hall's compete for this British strongman. And dude, he's got a busted hip, and he still managed to take first and second in every competition. I'm like, holy shit! And he's so much bigger than the other guys he competes against. It's amazing.
I mean, if he's bigger, he should win.
No, because I'd still say Brian Shaw is the biggest man at the World Strongman competitions, and he's won four times, and I mean, he's got a good chance at winning a fifth if he can get his athleticism up a bit. But Martin Lisi's is probably one of the smaller competitors, and he won last year because of the fact that he's fast. And he's basically
what's
built a World's Strongest Man. It's strongman, but the world's version. And I know Brian and Martin are both going to compete at the Arnold coming up here in 6 weeks. So I'm looking forward to seeing those two to see who wins this time. Because, yeah, I mean, Martin's about Wolf's size. I think he's only about 330 pounds, so he's not far off from Wolf. And I know he's like 6'2", but they've got very similar builds. So it's kind of interesting to see this smaller strongman going up against these giants like, you know, Bjorn Thorsen and Brian Shaw, Eddie Hall, Robert Oberst. These guys are like towering over him. But yeah, I don't know. Interesting stuff. Okay, what the fuck? Where is Fuka? The little bitch.
He's all depressed that we're spending the night.
Oh, I swear to God, if they're not here when I'm like all ramped up and got an actual good session finally planned out, I'm gonna be fucking pissed.
I could do an impromptu one, maybe.
Well, the whole point is that these guys need to be here.
True.
I mean, like I said, Robert's got an excuse. He talked to me already a week ago saying, hey, that he wouldn't be here for the next couple weeks while he's dealing with playoffs and everything like that. So I was like, oh, hey, you know, it's, you know, a one-off anyways. This isn't supposed to be a major portion of the campaign. So if you're gone, you're gone. He's like, yeah, you can replace me if you need to for the campaign. I'm like, no, I'm not going to do that. You know, this is a one-off. If it was the main campaign, yeah, I'd probably send you guys with an NPC or something like that. But
I mean, why a temporary player?
Yeah, that was the other option. Because that is what rejected potential is. I swear to God, Fuka. Get off your fucking... I'm going to keep bothering him until he fucking answers. I'm just personally PMing him. Come on, man. Where
are
you at?
Enter keys that I'm hearing.
Yes, I'm angrily typing. He should be in here. I know he's in a depressed mood about some stuff that was going on with someone else. That
that wasn't my fault, right? Because if so, I'm gonna apologize.
No, it's something between him and one of his old guildmates from FF.
FF14, yeah.
Yeah.
Shit sucks.
Here, I'll mute myself on stream so you
Alright. You muted the stream, right?
Yeah, no, I muted myself on
stream.
OBS. Yeah, I did a second ago. Okay. But I unmuted myself now just to say it.
Oof.
Yeah. It is what it is. I mean, it didn't bother me. I just happened to find out when I was going through Instagram. I was like, oh, and then my comment got deleted. I said, oh, the beach still looks nice, though. Dude, come on. Answer your damn... Here, I'm going to jump out and start a call with him. Answer your damn call. He's ignoring me.
Did you hear what I said?
No.
I just said don't stream it.
I mean, I did, but it was silent.
Okay, just because you're spamming him doesn't mean you need to spam me.
I'm not spamming
Piss
you.
Off.
I'm not spamming you.
You're doing it in the silent guard chat.
I am.
But that's not spamming you specifically.
I'm not going. I'm not adding you.
Yeah, but it's still popping up every 3 seconds.
It's not my fault. I mean.
Yes, it is. That's exactly what it is. And it's nothing else but your fault.
Oops.
Ooh, wrong guy. Wrong guy.
Well, it's hard to type this out because he's got a weird name.
Can't you just do N, tab, enter?
No, because it goes to Zima when I do that. Because of, I don't know, because I have a nickname for, Trent.
No, just literally. Wait, you have a nickname?
Yeah, I have a nickname for Trent on my.
Really different. Just do at and tab, enter.
Well,
it'll go to food guy.
No, because it goes to me when I do that.
What?
Mm-hmm. There we go.
You don't even have an N in your name, except for the middle.
Nope, my personal account name does, though. I know you're here, you little bitch. Get in here, Fuka. I swear to God, where are you? He's not on the stream chat either. What the fuck? Fuck him and all he stands for if he is not here today. I swear to God, I will kick him off the Rejected Potential campaign.
Don't kick the guy when he's down.
I will. That's what I'm good at.
Don't kick the guy when he's down.
No, fuck off. That's what I'm good at and that's what I'm going to do.
Hello, Trent.
Hello.
Hi, Trent. Good. Trent, help me spam Fuka.
Okay. Yeah. Here, I can do it. You can stop. Yeah, I can do it. I can do it better.
Can you?
Yeah, I really can.
Are you just gonna copy paste it? Jesus.
He's very good at being annoying.
Wait, Trent, do you have a script set up for that?
What?
You coded your own script. That's awesome. Oh my God! The apprentice is slowly learning. That's
Wait,
awesome.
Made a fucking macro.
Yeah, you did.
Nope, well, I just have fingers. See?
It's all that jerking off he does.
Yep, it's honestly quite. It's quite an honest.
Oh, he's control V-ing it.
Yep.
Oh my God.
Well, he doesn't have the annoying enter key every few seconds.
No, he still has to press the enter.
Yes, but you don't hear his enter button like you do mine.
Oh.
Because I've got a loud fucking keyboard because I'm cheap.
Wait, I thought mechanical keyboards were supposed to be expensive.
It's not a mechanical keyboard. It's a cheap piece of shit Acer keyboard that I bought for $10. And it came with a mouse. No, I found out that there's a thing. So for those watching on here, if you're a first-time home buyer, in the future, just as a good piece of advice, if you have a decent credit score, which is roughly above 700, then you can actually get a very low loan requirements for getting a house for first-time buyers. It's up to like 3.5% of the original of the overall price is all you have to put up, which is a lot cheaper than what most people have to deal with when putting up a house, which is usually 20%. And you can get deals to close a lot quicker through this as a first-time buyer. Depending on the neighborhood, it can be a little harder to get that going through. So if you're looking for a house that's like $600,000, you're not going to probably get that. But something between $100,000 to $300,000 is actually pretty easy to get set up through this program, depending on the neighborhood. So, yeah, good piece of advice for those who are first-time home buyers. What was that, Wolf?
What?
Oh, I thought you were trying to make a comment.
No.
Although for those of you who are overseas and or north of the border, this does not apply to you. Yeah, the states are the only ones that I know of that offer it. I mean, it might be offered internationally, but you'd have to look into your local laws.
Just go buy a place in a different country and then rent it out.
100 milliseconds.
What, Trin?
I'm looking at a spam script.
Oh, yeah. Well, you can code a spam script really easy, too.
Yeah, I could, but...
Just buy a place in a different country and rent it out.
That's true, you could.
Easy income. If you have enough capital, obviously, but still. And that is why people, the poor can get poorer and the rich get richer.
You're sending messages too quickly. I got in trouble with Discord.
Yeah, let's see. Okay, so...
Jesus, where is he? What the hell?
Here, DM, do you want me to just message you this? Send you this?
No, I'm good. I have spam macros in here. I don't use any of that stuff because I get in trouble.
Yeah, fair enough.
Yeah.
I don't want to send that anyone so that no one can do that to me.
Why does something tell me that the DM has a, electronic spam?
Well, I have, I've used spams in the before.
I just remembered something that I can do that Fuka will love.
What?
It's a little thing I like to call copy-paste.
Yeah, that's what I just did.
Oh, yeah. I just realized what I'm gonna buy with my first paycheck.
Oh, what's up?
A smoker so that I can make bacon.
That's awesome, man.
3 days. All I need is 3 days and it's gonna be the best thing, probably.
Jeez. Okay. Alright, I'm gonna give it another 5 minutes. If he's not here, then he's not here.
Okay, wait. Oh, I remember. Okay. Let's just go on Notepad.
I think he is just being a pain in
no,
the
I
butt.
Trent.
Oh, Trent, are you trying to script right now? No. Oh my god. Oh, you're doing full paragraphs.
Sweet Jesus. You know, it only still adds him one time, right?
Oh,
so
I know.
Doing that multiple times. You're just annoying other people.
I mean, it doesn't bother us either, because again, it only alerts us once. Poor Wolf, his phone's going off every 2 seconds now.
Just change servers, Wolf. Just change servers, or hit the friends thingy.
The mute on this thing? You can mute the server. That's what I've got going right now. Oh my god.
Oh my.
Where is he? Is he being a little bitch? Is that the thing? Or... Here, wait. He might be on Crusader Kings.
I referred to him as cum slut.
Oh, I mean.
Well, I mean.
He's offline. He's been offline for an hour.
Huh. Maybe he's busy.
Okay, he shouldn't be.
He might be. If he's busy, then I'm not.
Well, I can bother him on here, too.
That's what one of my players wants.
What?
What Frass just sent, basically. That's basically what
someone just pretty much just sent me this and told me to make it, so I just made it.
Oh, a gun. They want a Gundam?
Yeah, Gunpla.
Yep, someone in my game wants that.
The legs are so bulky, I love it, actually.
If you want to give him a Gundam, Trin, my best recommendation is to do.
No, I don't want to.
Do an Iron Golem, and then have a wizard who can use a variation of Moldorth just crush the damn thing.
You know, that would take, like, honestly, an entire campaign
to
maybe get. Maybe at the
maybe.
End.
I don't know if I told you this, DM, but it's in the Bronze Age, so.
I mean, you could theoretically build it, and you know they made a bronze bowl. They can make that. It's just
yeah, but bronze is soft metal.
That's true. I mean, they still could make it. It's not to say they couldn't. It would just crush itself in its own weight.
Hand waving on, you know, how soft bronze is in that game. I've only done it like once so far, and that's just because someone wanted a great sword. So mm-hmm. I'm like, yeah, sure.
Well, I mean, you could theoretically mix that with a little bit of a material they find. You want a fun one? You should make them learn how to make their own soap. No joke, I did that for a campaign. It took players about 4 sessions to figure out how they could make soap. And they finally realized they could use seashells crushed up to make it with, I think it's animal fat, if I remember right?
Yeah, it's animal fat. Pretty sure that's one of them.
Yeah, because crushed up seashells makes, I can't remember what the fuck
something,
it's called.
Something
starts with an L. Well, if you're the chemist, what's a material that starts with an L?
There are so many.
One that would be used
what
in soap.
Crush,
Lime?
Seashells. Lime. Limestone?
Limestone. That's what I was thinking. Yes. Yeah, you can make that in the limestone, and you can use limestone to make soap, I believe. Let me look it up. I got it written somewhere here.
I don't watch Gundam, but I kind of want to make more.
Why did you send the Gundam there? Now that's just going to make the weeb want one more.
Yep, and it's going to annoy the shit out of you.
He is. It's
what?
He's going to be like, can I please have that? And I'm like, you can certainly try.
What are you guys referencing?
It's my campaign.
Oh, is he on your server or something?
Yeah, Fraz.
I'm just Esther Days next month, you know.
Okay.
Tracy says hi.
Hi, Tracy.
I don't know if she's alone. But...
I could make a joke, but I'm going to avoid.
I should go buy another one.
Oh, I just realized I have Fuka's number. I don't know why.
You can call him once. Don't be like a queen girlfriend or something.
Well, right now I'm spam texting him.
Don't do that. There's a difference when doing it on Discord.
No, I'm an asshole and I don't mind it.
Well, I'm gonna be scared for your phone bill next time.
Why? I've got unlimited. I don't give a shit.
Never mind that shit.
Yeah.
It's 8:15.
I know. I'm just trying to see if I can get his text through text messages. All right, he'll join whenever he joins. I sent him like 12 text messages in the last 2 seconds. So, all right. Let's get back into Mugu the Cuddler's great adventures.
I kind of want to swap him out this round.
Why?
I don't know. I'm having fun testing these things out.
Well, learn to
one
test out another character.
Session. A character every session.
Go join up with another campaign to test out other characters. You're stuck with Mugu until he dies.
Suicide.
Or mentally breaks,
Mugu
one of the two.
Walks into the ocean and horses can't swim, so he dies. It's okay, I have a new character. Say, like, someone threw a carrot in the ocean. I don't know.
I throw a carrot in the ocean. DM, can I roll?
Can I at least describe what's going on before you assholes can ruin the campaign?
Yeah, sure.
Okay.
You gotta let the DM talk, for fuck's sake. Oh, God. Now, okay. So, we come back to from last session where the party ended with a large argument between both Houdini and Nimian, who apparently has decided to fuck right off and disappear. We can only guess it's due to irritation. We blame Houdini. And thus, because of that, Nimian has not arrived. The rest of the group had managed to meet a very interesting fellow who spoke very uniquely and explained to them... Yeah, let's go with that. Explain to them
Mugu
that
attacks him.
Well, Mugu can't attack
no.
him. He's gone.
He's gone.
Again,
yeah, that was last session.
Allow the DM to explain what was going on before you assholes start planning your own shit. All right, goddamn. I mean, like a minute. Fuck. So yes, as far as it goes, after he opened or raised the bridge of golden light for the players to go over, he managed to vanish after answering very few questions and adding even less answers. The group has found themselves in the village of dead Arakakra that Nimian managed to drown.
And then fuck right off.
And and Zima decided to basically do fuck all, like usual. While the rest of the party kind of stood around asking questions that that they really didn't get any proper answers to. They also found their favorite and new friend named Mugu the Cuddler, who managed to cuddle an iron cage to open it up so he could eat more carrots.
Yep.
As the Arakakra were trying to sacrifice his body to allow his spirit to be free and him to be reborn as the god they believed him to be, bathing him in all sorts of great smelling seasonings, and he still smells like a mix of lime, lavender, and a little bit of what smells like barbecue chips. The most pleasant smelling character in the entire world I've ever made or ever seen. And yes, we come back to the session where it is night. The time is around 9 p.m. The party settles in inside, I assume, the chieftain's hut, where it is the most comfortable and spacious. And
sleep standing.
Yes.
So I'm standing.
You guys are very creeped out by the fact that Mugu just stands and closes his eyes and start and kind of his head rolls a little forward and he's out like a light.
Nice.
Snoring very loudly, obnoxiously so. All right. And then watch was never decided upon. I assume Mugu is not going to be joining watch, so.
Nope.
So Houdini, of course, staying awake for a good chunk of it. Are you going to take all of watch, Houdini, or?
And not get any kind of long rest?
Pretty much.
I can just go into a trance.
As Zima can. You also have Falazar, who is still there, who has joined your, has kind of stuck around with your guys' group.
I mean, I'm pretty sure I can still see it. I still kind of figure out what's going on if I'm in a trance.
First watch for 4 hours, and then you, and then whatever else, and then probably Falazar.
Mm-hmm. Alright. So Falazar will take last watch.
No, it's gonna be me first.
Alright, let me just see something real quick. Yep, yeah, go ahead and give me a perception check, both of you.
14 plus 5, 19.
Okay. Nothing seems to go on. The bridge continues to glimmer as you watch out. The sea comes in, the cool air, it gets cooler, the smell of salt on the air, the occasional fish jumping out of the ocean. Otherwise, it seems rather quiet. And the fire slowly dies down that was out where Mugu's iron cage is still sitting up on, by the way. Still red hot. That no one seemed to care about. Yes.
It's not like we're doing it.
And yeah, the evening goes on quietly. Zima, yes, you can do a trance. However, you are semi-conscious, which means you have disadvantage at perception checks. So.
I'll just do trance while he's taking watch.
And okay.
Then I'll trade out with him.
All right.
Long rest.
Yep, it's a long rest technically.
Okay.
But go ahead, Zima, and give me your perception check.
Okie dokie, let me take out my dice. Perception. Where is that? That's right there. That is an 8.
Okay. The sea continues to come in quietly. The occasional seagull on the air comes in, squawking, looking for food on the ground, eating the back the bucket of carrots that's been left out. It makes you realize seagulls don't eat carrots. And again, nothing happens. The night is quiet as it gets darker and darker. The stars are gorgeous as they twinkle in the air. It's a rather cold out. It's gotten rather cold outside. The fire is completely dead at this point. The sound of the embers crackling and crickling as you sit there and relax, really enjoying the whole situation.
Who has had the most amount of sleep right
now? Mugu.
I don't want to wake him.
And,
yeah, no, you don't.
Well, Falazar will be taking third watch.
Okay.
So
when Falazar is done with third watch, I'm going to go fishing.
Oh, in the morning? Okay. So as you head out, or head back in with the night going on, you head inside to wake Falazar. He grumpily wakes up, grabs his demon and/fiend and goes out and sits on the front porch whittling away at some pieces of wood that he finds on the beach, enjoying the morning. As you lot come out as you lot come out the next morning and the sun rises, the occasional seagull still squawking. Mugu, you find your carrots are completely gone, and find the occasional seagull feather around the bin. You smell the strong scent of chicken on the air, cooking chicken. The fire pit has been relit, the cage has been moved, and Falazar seems to be sitting there with a couple of little sticks in the ground with what looks to be either seagull or Eric Cochran. You're not sure. Some are bigger pieces than other, but they've all been defeathered and skinned to a certain degree, and it's kind of hard to tell at this point what they were.
I guess Falazar beat Seema to fishing, huh?
Well, none of them seem like fish. And as you guys come out, he kind of waves you over, and there's about 12 little sticks sticking over the fire that have been cooking for a couple hours. The smell of a nice, warm, burning flesh, taking some of the seasoning that was left over from Mugu's release, let's go with. He hands each of you a piece and just continues to eat and relaxes and tells you that he has nothing to report as far as the previous morning, or the overall night.
Where'd you get this?
He looks to you, says, some of the bodies washed up onto the sea, well, pieces of them, and a couple of the seagulls decided to fatten themselves up on the carrots, from what I saw.
Is this the seagull, or is this the other one?
Well, I mean, he refers to the seagulls as what he was that ate the carrots. He also, as I stated, mentions that he did get a couple body parts of the Eric Cochran that washed up on the shore.
I mean, it's the one I'm holding, the seagull.
You don't know. It smells mouthwatering, though. As the strong scent of barbecued chicken hits you with the smell of what is some sort of lime mixed spice on it.
Lime? Oh, the fruit. Okay.
Yes, Mugu?
This isn't cannibalism, right?
No.
Just making sure. Okay.
Well.
Is that your favorite?
Are you Eric Cochran? I mean.
No.
Do you want
to
be?
Really,
I was going
to
say. No. This is like, it's the same idea as eating monkey in this concept. It's a primitive species.
Except it would be like me eating a human.
Aren't you half human?
This room goes silent. Everyone questions whether he means that in character or out of character. Alright, yeah, as you guys continue to eat, the quote-unquote chicken, the bird tastes amazing as it's charred to perfection, and you realize Falazar has a natural knack for cooking. The bridge is still sparkling. Nimian is nowhere to be found as of current. And the day seems to be wrapping up to be rather warm.
Let's walk, shall we?
Does anybody have any issues with going over the Golden Bridge?
No.
I Mugu, are you going to take a nosedive off the bridge?
Yes.
Oh my god.
Does a backflip.
I was gonna say, do you want to roll a dexterity to see if you can do a backflip for style?
Yes. And then I want to punch a shark while I'm drowning. And then I will die.
So, are you just going to replace it right now, or is it going to be later?
Right now.
Okay. Where's your character sheet? I want to see it. Jesus.
Oh, the new one? Yeah. Or Mugu the Cuddler?
Mugu the Cuddler is always up.
Mugu the Cuddler burns a key point to use Step of the Wind. So he can run at... Wait, hold on.
Yeah, you gotta give me a reason. What comes over...
195 feet per turn.
Okay, now what comes over Mugu that causes him to do this? I mean, he's a very bright horse, as we all know.
Yeah. He sees the seagulls.
Mm-hmm.
And where the carrots were, and that they're not there anymore. And he sees the seagulls flying out over the water.
Mm-hmm.
So he, like, runs, like, 200 feet up the bridge.
Mm-hmm.
Like, jumps off the bridge and tries to punch one out of the air.
Roll dexterity and an attack roll. Oh my god.
Alright. Dexterity or attack roll?
Both. Dexterity first.
Dexterity first. Skills. Show me. There you go. 5. Dexterity.
Alright.
Hold on, I'm gonna use, what's it called?
The nope.
Thing? Inspiration.
Okay.
No, I can't use no,
because you have no idea what's going on here. So, as you just see, you just see this horseman charge up the bridge at full speed, and while he charges up, he jumps with all the gloriousness of his species that he can show, grabs a bird and punches it straight in the face. However, at least that's how he envisions it, as he charges off the bridge, both his front legs tripping, causing him to tumble forward, at landing ass first onto a seagull, and it charging down into the water, squishing it. Mugu seems very confused as he starts to squelch and squeal as he's going under the water. He slowly starts to drown. You guys are just left in shock and awe as this is going on.
Alright, so how is he going to get into the other game?
Huh?
How is the Wolfsby character going to get into this?
Oh, I sent Wolf the link. It's in the chat, so he can click it.
How is he
going to... Oh, I've got a way, don't worry.
How is his character going
to... The DM can work in anything. This is what I'm good at, is making it up as I go. In fact, some might say I'm better when I have to make it up as I go. As we remember the Venkos session, which was still, by this date, the most epic session we've had. So yes, as you watch him go tumbling off, Mugu slowly sinks beneath the ocean, just drifting away quietly. His last words were...
Fuck you, seagull.
As you hear him shout out, fuck you, seagull. Gets out with a straight face. The horseman sinks better than he floats. And like a brick going into the deepest of oceans, falls beneath. But with his last dying breath, as he gasps for air, not understanding why he sinks, especially with an item like the belt of storm or the belt of storm giant strength, you guys suddenly see a, as you walk up to the bridge, trying to catch where Mugu went, and, you know, being actually concerned for your funny and entertaining companion, a shark suddenly flies out of the water with an imprint of a fist on it, and lops back into the water, floating upside, or belly up.
Is it dead?
It's not moving, and fish that usually float belly up are typically dead.
Does anyone have Mage Hand? Its move is last strophe. We need to retrieve it.
Mage hand. I do have mage hand.
Okay.
What are you trying to retrieve?
I say Mugu is too way down in the deep. You won't be able to see him. Oh, you're gonna retrieve the shark. All right. Okay. Zima, you're gonna cast Mage Hand to get the shark.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Wait, let's. All right. You pull this 100-pound great, what looks to be a small great white, out of the water. You see it's very, it's got a surprised look on its face as all of its teeth are slowly falling out of its mouth as it's being hoisted up into the air 200 feet. You now have a dead baby great white shark floating in the air.
Put it in the bridge.
Okay. It's just set on the bridge. There's now a dead baby shark, great white baby shark, on the bridge with no teeth.
I'm gonna ask Falazar to preserve it.
Falazar goes up to it, takes out his flaming axe, and just starts chopping it up.
And keep the head intact for the trophy.
And that's 15 rations to add to his inventory.
The circle.
All I will mention, Zima and Houdini, give me a perception check.
That is an 11.
That's a nat
20
plus 5.
Okay, never mind.
All right. So you both see a bright flash of a green light, coming from the ocean, and bubbles for a second, and then it vanishes, just like that.
That's it?
Yep.
Roll in Arcana on that?
It disappears before you get the chance to really realize what you just saw.
Alright, fair enough.
Investigation.
It was a bright light in the ocean, and you have no idea what it was.
Alright, thanks.
Perception. It was a bright, very vibrant green light that flew off that left nothing in its wake except for the fact that it contradicted with the water.
Animal handling.
Alright, we're done.
The shark has been turned into rations and successfully chopped up so well that you have to pay respect to the skeleton. The head is on the skeleton, and as Falazar finishes up, he chops it and hands it over to Houdini. And I love that we're more upset about the poor shark than the damn fucking character dying.
Well, he wants to die.
You guys don't know that!
True.
Mugu didn't want to die.
He's stupid enough to do that, so
that's true.
It's just his stupidity getting to him.
Well, I'd rather it be him than me.
That's, you know, hey, that's a fair thought process at this point. Alright, as you guys continue up the bridge, now a party of technically 3 adventurers and 1 pet, and a shark head.
Can I put the shark head on my shoulder?
Like, are you gonna wear it like a mask, or?
Wait, can I do that?
Do you have,
feel free.
Do you have any rope?
I have an mask.
Do I have any rope?
You should have a rope, that's your starting thing.
Where the hell? Do I not have rope?
You have no rope, but let's see. You do have commoner's clothing, although you'd have to tear your own clothing off and walk in naked. You could use your bedroll.
Vegetation.
To make a rope.
Yeah.
Can't get the bits in your hand? Question mark.
I mean, technically. He can. You okay, can create a non-magical... I would say rope is a trinket, as long as it's not more than, 5 feet.
Sure. Is that all? I'll do that.
That's more than... No, you could probably do about 2 feet, and you'd probably... If that's plenty to tie this thing onto your face.
Okay.
Can
that's
he
what
still
I'm doing.
See?
Yeah, he can still see through the mouth. He now has a shark mask on. Given... Now, let me explain this for those who are watching at home, and those few who do. This is a character who is minor nobility, spent his entire life at a college learning, studying, and being one of the most well-educated characters to this day, even more than Zilpip was when he first started out. And he is now walking up here with a shark mask on his face and some rope.
Listen, listen. College was hard, all right? College was hard.
Those frat parties really got him ready for this scenario. Zima thinks back on those early days of when he first joined the fraternity and was forced to dress as a full shark and scare the new, the other freshmen. He looks on with that memory fondly.
That is why, until this date, I wear a shark.
This is when Houdini suddenly realizes there's a small little shark sewn into Zima's clothing. Always wonder. That is now a canon thing. No, fuck you. We're not doing that damn song. God damn it.
Baby.
No, I have two cousins. I've had to hear that so often. No. So yeah, as you guys are continuing up, Zima, you now have a plus one to intimidation.
Oh, yeah.
With this shark mask on your face.
I love that.
It smells of chum.
Prestidigitation to make,
the mask smell better?
Yeah.
It's a fresh kill. It's still bleeding as he's putting it on his face.
Why the hell did you put it in your head?
Because it's Tren. Even when he plays smart characters, he still finds weird shit to do.
I'm going to cast Mending on the head so that it doesn't bleed anymore.
Okay. Yes, as you cast Mending, the shark head's head calluses over on the back of the neck. Do sharks? I don't want to have that discussion right now. The back of the head where it was cut and severed now is completely sealed up and scarred over. The shark still smells, but it is no longer bleeding fresh blood on you, Zima. You feel rather disappointed, as that was another fond memory from college that we won't go into. So yes, not that. God damn you people. Jesus, I was thinking something way different. As you guys continue heading up.
That's a lot of something, those who are supposed to say.
As you guys continue up. God damn it. Fucking god damn you, Wolf. How am I supposed to work that in here?
Oh, hold on. Just give me 1 second, then you can refresh and I have a description written up. Just 1 second.
Alright, we'll buy time while we do this. As you guys do continue walking up the, bridge, you admire the seagulls and think fondly onto your past teammates. Thinking back on the adventure of killing succubi, a giant succubi, watching Zima get molested.
Song about Farlar.
Yes, as you start to write a song about Farlar and Mugu.
Different songs, by the way. They're different people.
Alright, go ahead. Give me what your rendition of that would be.
I said I'm writing. I have no idea what I'm supposed to say.
Alright, start to come up with some ideas and tell us the ideas that you're thinking out loud. Start singing fucking dwarven pub songs. Alright. No. Oh my god. Okay. Wait, are you... Okay, I know what you are. Fucking god. How am I... fuck. Okay, I have an idea. Do you have a backstory, or do you want me to make this up as I go?
You can do whatever you want. I have a backstory, but you can do whatever you want.
I mean, I got one that might... okay, well, if you've got a backstory... I don't see the backstory in there, so...
Look at the faith thing. If you have any of those...
I don't.
Okay, well, you know.
Want me to bullshit something for you?
Yeah.
All right. So as Houdini starts shouting out or singing out dwarven pub songs in the background, let me see. I've got a good one here. There you go. We'll put that in the background for music and enjoy the copyright claim later. All right. And that's all we're going to get of that song before I get in trouble for it.
All
right. There was once a man who was like a horse.
Yes.
Yes, I've added a bunch of feats from 3.5's military command stuff for future reference. That's what I did. And there's going to be more and more being added as time goes on. So, as I was stating, Oh, yes, Houdini starts to sing out. Go ahead, Houdini, let's give it a thought.
No, I actually have no idea. I have no idea how to go on after that.
There was once a man who was like a horse.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I'm just fucking throwing shit. See what sticks.
All right, keep going, man. Let's work it out.
I don't know. We're still fucking buying time, so just keep on buying.
Well,
time.
No, we've got time now. As you guys continue up, you're gonna have to figure out why you're here for this one. I'm not gonna be able to come up with that reason unless you really want me to, but you may not agree with it.
I'm good with creating a reason to be here.
Okay, good. So as you reach the top of the Golden Bridge. You guys start to see a creature standing at the top of the temple, just standing there. Would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Wait, hold on. What was my name again? Yorgar or something.
Yes, that's actually right. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. What up, guys? I heard Farlar died. The Order of the Owl sent me to replace him.
Because
the Order of the Owl still wants their money's worth on this quest.
Meanwhile, you just see Houdini strumming along with a little, some magical instruments, some Irish music. Oh my god. Alright, that works.
You're a bunch of idiots.
You just see, I mean, you immediately recognizing Houdini from your organization, and having been notified immediately after Farlar's death upon the realization that the whole entire group of the Order of the Owl puts little tags on their employees to let them notify them as soon as they die, so that way they can collect upon their death insurance. Realizing you're nothing more than an insurance claim for them. yeah, you guys continue on, or meet up at the gate, and you see that there is a young elven man with a mask on his, shark head on his face, and a large-looking Goliath who stands about equal footing with you in size. Houdini seems to be whispering to himself. He has four limbs. His in-between's unknown. Completely confused on what the fuck's going on.
I just see him and
so
just didn't
what
see
you guys them. See in front of you is a 6'8 red orc with the...
Hey, Wolf? Oh, shit.
I have, like... I'm pretty hairy, but, like, no hair on my head. Got a big beard, but, like, a bunch of hair all over my arms.
I'm just imagining a bald Sasquatch.
And, I have this, like, really, really finely made, it looks almost platinum, like, half-plate armor. No helmet, but I, yeah. Like, kind of sharpened teeth and white eyes.
All right.
Since I do see a new person, I'm just gonna put back my stuff and greet them. Yeah, I'm Houdini. I assume you already know that, and you are.
Yeah. Huh? I'm
your
Yordar.
Name. Yordar. Yorgar.
Yeah. I heard Farlar screwed the pooch.
So,
yeah.
I got a cool shark mask out of it.
That's a different guy. That's a different guy.
Yeah.
This guy seems very intelligent.
We're all gonna die.
Definitely. Let's try to make it fun, shall we?
As you guys finally reach over the bridge, you notice the golden, and make it to the foot of the temple. Looking up, this thing has six pillars, each with different markings on it. And there's about 20 stairs between you and getting up to the entrance that seems to narrow into a smaller hallway as you look further down and goes into what looks to be a bigger room with more statues inside from what you can tell from this distance. But as you guys finally make the final steps over the bridge, you hear a kind of slight mixing of magical words that seems to be in a language none of you recognize, and the bridge seems to vanish within seconds.
You may have dispelled a blessing of the stone.
What?
Comprehend languages.
I do have comprehend languages, yes.
It as you try to catch it, it doesn't seem to catch in time. And as you guys continue looking about, each of the pillars seems to, from what you can recognize, represent one of the gods of the Church of Adventures, each having their own specific kind of pillar, each of a strong marble color with a golden engraving of the markings.
How many statues are there?
There's the of pillars, there are six that you can see. And yeah. So as you guys are looking up above you, of course, this thing very much has a triangle-like roof that seems to also have a depiction of looks to be the six heroes from the Church of Adventures fighting off what looks to be six different dragons, varying looks and appearances. And yes, what? Let me get our nice and lovely. All right, and I assume you guys, you lot, are gonna start to go head inside. At this point.
Yeah, I'm walking behind the rest of the group in case there are any traps.
Okay.
Wow.
Smart man.
The guy in the armor is behind the barn.
Yep.
Yeah.
So as you guys, yes.
Falzer's in front. Behind.
Alright, as Falzar takes point with his gorgeous and lovely poisonous pet.
Actually, yeah, Zima's behind Falzar, not me.
What?
Zima's behind Falzar, not me.
Okay, so the walking order is Falzar, the Hezrau, Zima, and then Houdini, and then Yorgar.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. As you guys start to walk in, the hallway is dark. Pitch black, very narrow, only enough for you guys to barely fit in one by one, as it seems that both Yorgar and Falzar are kind of having issues with their broader shoulders marching into this temple.
Did you say pitch black?
Yes.
We have dark vision. Well, most of us. So
yes. I don't believe...
Pretty sure all of us have dark vision.
Yeah, looks like it. I think Goliaths do. I don't recall.
Maybe they do. It's been a while since I played it.
Goliath just forced their eye muscles.
They forcefully,
They just like
dilate their pupils to get more light in.
Yep, that's exactly how it goes.
Add that in. That sounds hilarious.
And no, Goliaths actually don't have it, surprisingly enough.
I'm just going to cast light on one of his
I can cast light as a cantrip. I'm good.
All right, have him cast light.
So...
light. There you go.
So I was going to state, as you guys start about halfway down the hallway, you start to notice that there, for those who have dark vision, you start to see the stances that are sitting up on the higher up on the walls of like what looks to be a black ichor of sorts and how the metal is designed, very tentacled-like. Almost like a Lovecraftian design. They suddenly light as you make it to the halfway mark and going down into the hallway as if you're expected.
Keep what? The light on. Something tells me it's definitely going to turn off later.
What? Yagstoth? What?
As you guys continue on, Falazar readying his axe. His great axe, might I admit. You guys make it to what looks to be a center room that's completely perfectly circular and round. It has what looks to be six statues, each one sitting, all very large with no face carved into them, but each of them seems to represent one of the different classes. As you look about, the chairs are all identical. Each of the statues are made of what looks to be a rough blackened marble with a white marble background. And the first one sitting in the directly in front of you as you guys cross looks to be a very similar to the man you saw earlier, in fact. Very simple looking human with a chest sitting on his lap and him holding it shut with what looks to be a chain in his arm wrapped around it.
God damn it, we met the first event, the first guy.
The chest has a light that seems to emit from it, and there are stairs going up towards the chest into the keyhole where the light is emitting from. Seems to be a bright, almost blinding light that you guys can see in this room.
I'm just gonna tell your girl real quick. There's a guy that told us not to fuck with the chest, so don't fuck with the chest.
Got it, fuck with the chest.
The other statues, one by one, the first one on the left of what you now assume to be as Reed, the man you met earlier, seems to be a rather giant-looking man. Again, race isn't very discernible, and the face isn't carved in at all. It's blank slate completely. Holding what looks to be a giant battle axe in one hand and a sword in the other. And he looks very similar to how the hammer is depicted. Large, terrifying, and aggressive. No light is coming off of him. But you also notice that at the bottom in between his feet on the chair is carved some wording. As you continue to look on, the next one beside him to the left looks to be a man in robes. One holding a sword and the other what looks to be a symbol of no real god. It just seems to be a blank symbol of some sort, representing almost a mixing of different religious symbols. Same thing with in between his feet on the chair. Again, seems to be that there's writing on the next to him on the left and behind you guys, where you guys seem to actually walk out of, seems to be a man who again is in robes, very simple robes with horns coming off his head. One holds what looks to be a magic staff. The other hand holds a book. And on his chest seems to be a pendant with a blood red gem in the center of it. That's literally the size of Yorgar from this look of it. And above the doorway, you see again more words. Again, to the left of that character seems to be a young boy whose feet don't really touch the ground, holding what looks to be a bow in his hand and petting what looks to be a rather large... You're not sure if it's a wolf or some sort of dog, but it looks to be something of the canine design. Again, at the bottom of the chair seems to be words, right? Your perfect height. And the last one seems to have the face actually carved into it. Looks like a very grizzled looking orc with leather patches of what looks to be some sort of clothing, what looks to be like deer horns coming off his head, and a really gnarled looking staff in one hand. You recognize each of these as the hammer, the pious one, the elder, the son, and the old wolf. The six heroes of the Church of Adventurers. And the room seems to light up perfectly. On the ground, it seems to have at the center is a small little circle with giant wording on it that says, "To pass, you must answer each of the riddles."
Oh boy, puzzles.
"For those who do not, may dismay take you."
Zima, comprehend languages real quick, see what it says for Falzer. Falzer has the rune reading thing. I'm
so, yes, I believe so.
Just tell me one.
Let me look.
No, hold on. Yeah, Falzer has a thing with his warlock thingy.
Falzar's not a warlock, he's a paladin.
Who's the warlock with the rune reading thing?
That was Kilxius.
Oh shit, whoops.
Uh-huh.
The same guy by a different character.
But it seems that as you guys walk up to each of the statues, kind of inspecting the room, and feel free to give me investigation rolls for those who want to get real deep into
yes,
it.
This is my specialty.
I could just read the room.
Each of the...
So
yes.
That is a 17 plus 11.
Okay. So first off, what you realize, Zima, is that Each of these carvings seem to have some sort of magical presence as they seem to change. Being a man of language, you notice that the carvings on these statues seem to that have these riddles written onto them seem to each have some sort of enchantment that changes the language based on the person who's reading it. So as you read it, it seems to flash through almost every language you know, and you completely comprehend it no problem. And you see answers down on the bottom of it, but none of them make sense as they've been kind of carved in by someone else's handwriting from what you can tell. It looks like to almost answer these, or those who have answered these, have had their answers carved into the statues as wrong answers. Around the room, though, it looks like, again, you don't see anything else that's very unique, nothing that gives you a hint to what's going on, but you get the idea that by answering these riddles, there might be some sort of mechanism that might go off, or some sort of magical presence that might be appearing. What does catch your attention is that some of the statues have slight cracks in them, and you sense a strong magical presence behind it.
Behind the statues?
Within the statues, yes, sorry.
Okay. What's the riddle?
Alright, which one do you want to go up to first? There are six. There is...
six?
Yes.
Let me get my notepad out.
Let's go with Reed first.
Okay.
Reed?
Yeah.
The main one? It's okay.
Or not.
Well, if you guys want to talk it over, feel free.
Nope.
Yeah.
What are our options?
Alright, so the six heroes, as listed, are Reed, the first hero, the pious one, the hammer, the elder, the sun, and the old wolf. Each of these represent the different classes of D&D.
Let's go for the barbarian first.
All right, the hammer. Okay. So as you walk up, the riddle on it says, "What is it that we love more than life, fear more than death? The rich want it, the poor have it, the miser spends it, and the spendthrift saves it."
I swear to God, I've heard this before.
The spendthrift?
Spendthrift.
I'm basically a guy who spends a lot of money. That's what it means.
I can feel someone Googling this.
No. I try to be fair. Not this time.
So, what is it that we love more than life, fear more than death? The rich want it, the miser spends it, the spendthrift saves it.
And the poor have it.
The miser is like, what's a miser?
It's someone that's like, really crotchety, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here's the deal, DM.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard this riddle before.
I hope so. And you can answer it.
Well, no, because like, my guy has...
doesn't mean he wouldn't get lucky. I'm letting the players actually answer this one, so go ahead.
Nothing.
As Yorgar shouts out loud, nothing, remembering this one riddle from his childhood that his mother would always tell him to remind him that one should fear nothing. The sounds of clacking are heard as the center of the room lowers a little bit. That circle that you guys originally saw that had the wording to answer the riddles seems to slowly dip a little bit, and a ladder is slowly exposed.
Cool.
All right. Which one would you like to go next?
Why is that related to barbarian?
Let's go...
it might be more related to the character themselves than the barbarian.
Yeah, fair enough.
Cleric?
Alright.
To who?
Cleric.
Oh, the cleric to pious.
Give me a second. Okay. It holds most knowledge that has ever been said, but is not the brain, is not the head. To feathers and their masters, tis both bane and boon, one empty and one full.
It holds most knowledge that's never been said, but it's not the brain and it's not the head. What was the rest?
To feathers and their masters, tis both bane and boon, one empty and one full.
It holds most knowledge that has ever been said,
or has not been said. I can't remember.
And it's not the brain, and I will, it's not the head.
If you guys want to look at the actual
just
text,
copy paste it into the
that's
chat.
That's what I did.
Thanks.
Mm-hmm. Just feathers messages. And their masters.
Can I just say I think without actually answering it?
Sure.
I think it's a book.
That would make sense. Well, wait.
Feathers, squirrel, don't know about the masters.
So feathers and their masters.
And don't know about the MTN poles.
It's both Bane and Boon. Books can be both a Bane and a Boon.
Knowledge, never been.
Second half. The second half's the important one.
Yeah. I think a book is.
Okay. You can answer a book if you want.
Yeah.
Alright. If it fails, I'm gonna apologize in advance. A book.
Okay, as you shout out loud, a book. Before you suddenly appears a man in his full robes. You recognize the race immediately as a water genocide. And he looks to you and says, "You have failed."
Oh, shit.
And immediately right next to him, he summons a giant weeping angel.
Keep looking.
And they just wait at the center of the circle, facing the statue that is now, as you notice, it starts to break.
All right. Do we get a chance to try a different answer?
Nope. Does the statue completely cracks and opens. It's and the riddle vanishes.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool. Neat. So these dudes are just chilling.
Yep, as of right now.
In the center of the circle.
Okay. Let's
You have the first hero left, the elder, the son, and the old wolf.
Druid.
Okay. So you go to the old wolf.
Paste it.
I will. I have rivers without water, forests without trees, mountains without rocks, and towns without houses. What am I?
Goddamn! Can we just skip it and go somewhere else, or are we?
You don't have to answer. If you want to choose a different one, if you don't have an idea, but you do eventually feel you have to answer them all.
We need to answer them all, whether or not it's going to be a fail or a success.
Yep, pretty much.
Alright, let's just read everything then. And then just,
So that's the one.
I have rivers without water, forests.
What? Oh, forests.
By the way, for those wondering, the previous one, the answer was paper, not book.
Ah, shit.
Sorry, technicality.
Oh, dude, you know what? I know this one.
All right, yeah. Go ahead.
Wait, hold on. I don't want to miss it.
Let's go to the other
You don't
one
have
then.
To say your final answer.
Guys, let's talk about this.
Yeah, let's talk about this.
I'm pretty sure it's a map.
Oh.
Think about it.
Huh. Everything adds up.
Huh.
But is it, question, is it map or a map?
That is not a technicality I will break you on.
Maps. The answer is maps.
I don't know why, but I was thinking ants, and I don't know why.
So,
why?
Is map your final answer?
I'm good with map. It sounds really close.
Else?
It sounds really close. I got nothing about this.
I mean, I have no idea.
I'm gonna go with GPS just for the hell of it, but no. Map. Map is good.
Alright. Final answer?
Yeah.
The riddle vanishes and the circle lowers a little bit. Nothing appears.
Next one. Let's go.
Alright. So, you have left the son, the elder, and the first hero. So, the ranger, the magic caster, and the first hero.
Are we just going to leave Reed for last? Let's leave Reed for last, since everyone seems to be avoiding him.
Okay. So which would you like?
I chose the ones you guys can pick one.
true. Why not the sun?
Okay.
Yeah, we're gonna go with the sun.
Alright. 10 men's strength, 10 men's length, 10 men can't break it, yet a young boy walks off with it. What is it?
Can you repeat? 10 men's strength.
10 men's length. 10 men can't break it, yet a young boy walks off with it.
Wow, that's a really old one. Or at least that's a really unknown one.
Well, it's something inexperience. No.
10 men's. Sorry, could you say it again? 10 men's.
10 men's strength, 10 men's length, 10 men can't break it, yet a young boy walks off with it.
Okay, see, here's the deal. This could be a lot of things. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, this could be, I don't know, just like a long steel pole or something. As long as it's skinny enough, a kid could pick it up and walk off with it.
It's... Why did you delete the riddle?
Because I don't want you Googling it.
But then again, we can just literally just ask you long. Over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
10 men's strength. What is...
Well, let's think of, like, things... That are strong enough.
10 men can't break it, yeah.
Could we just skip it and go for the other one?
You can. Next.
Okay, but here's the... Okay.
You will have to eventually answer it.
Yeah. No, I'd rather just stay at this and try and answer it until we
get it right. Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, fair enough.
Go ahead.
I feel like... It's a riddle, right? It's going to have a definitive answer.
Mm-hmm.
But there could be multiple things that fit this description. Unless I'm thinking about it all wrong.
Ten.
But I don't think I am.
What's something that's like as long as 10 men?
10.
As long as 10 men?
Yeah.
I mean, like, yeah, anything. Like a ladder, like...
It has the strength that has like the strength of 10 men. But a kid can carry it.
Like a...
Cord? I'm just waiting for...
Rope?
Reeds. 10 men can't break a rope.
Yeah, but 10 men can't break, like, a bunch of other things either.
I think true. It's rope.
10 men's length, too.
I don't know, dude.
I'm gonna say rope.
You're gonna say rope out loud?
I'm not, I'm gonna...
Yeah, I'm gonna say rope.
Okay.
I'm gonna go with no, and...
Alright, as you shout out rope, the thing fades away, and the circle sinks another inch.
Boom.
Oh, it is a rope. Nice. Right, we're gonna go with the old one next.
Alright, the elder?
Mm-hmm. It's okay. The elder in Reed, right?
Huh?
It's the elder in the first zero.
Say that again.
It's the elder in the first zero left.
Yes.
Okay, so we're gonna go with the elder. We're gonna leave the...
I have many tongues but cannot taste. By me, most things are turned to waste. I crack and snap, yet I stay whole. I may take the largest toll. I assisted all of the first men, and I will pay them back again. Around me, people snuggle and sleep, yet run when I am released from my keep. I jump around and leap and bound. The cold man wishes he had found.
What?
I'm not going to say this out loud, but I'm just thinking dog. I don't know.
Would you like me to read it again?
Yeah.
I have many tongues, but cannot taste. By me, most things are turned to waste. I crack and snap, yet I stay whole. I may take the largest toll. I assisted all of the first men, and I will pay them back again. Around me, people snuggle and sleep, yet run when I am released from my keep. I jump around and leap and bound. The cold man wishes I had that I he had found.
Fire? I'm not gonna say it out loud. I'm just thinking, throwing things out right
now. Yeah, tongue. Tongue. What's the tongue reference to the fire?
Many tongues but can't taste.
Fire yeah,
could have many tongues fire but can't.
I'm pretty sure there was a reference to a fire and a tongue. Like there was a connection between those two.
It said a cold man wishes they like had found me or something.
Yeah, but
that would be obvious,
well,
though.
I mean,
yes.
Around me, people snuggle and sleep.
Fuck. Can you just repeat it?
I can repeat it yet again. No worries. I have many tongues, but cannot taste. By me, most things are turned to waste.
A gibbering mouther.
I crack and snap, yet I stay whole. I may take the largest toll. I assist all of the first men, and I will pay them back again.
Yeah.
Around me.
I think it's fire.
Yeah. The assist the first men with the invention of fire. You know, crack and snap. That's what fire does.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm going fire.
Correct.
Sweet.
You have nothing but Reed left.
Okay, we're going.
Is the answer read?
It's okay. My character can't read, so I automatically pass.
All right.
Is there a shark race in D&D?
No. Give me a minute. I'm pulling up.
I'm just
okay.
Bring in a bunch of women just so that you can make the baby shark joke.
No. The riddle is simple. As you look at Greed's statue, all it says is, you must keep it after giving it.
Oh.
I want to say kindness. I'm
it's
not going to
promise.
Answer, I want to think
if I remember, it's promise. You must keep it after giving it. Yeah, give it a promise. You must keep the promise.
Oh, yeah, I've heard that one before.
Yeah, that's. I remember that one. I'm pretty sure it was promise. Unless the DM's being an asshole, I'm pretty sure it's promise.
Okay, wait. It could be a few things. Promise,
it could
oath,
be.
Vow.
Are you going to bend us over with that one?
I won't for that one, even though I should, but no, I won't. So is promise your final answer?
Yeah, if I remember, yeah, it's promise.
Technically, you're correct. It's your word, but I will take promise, because technically a promise is your word. As the riddle vanishes, however, you hear the thing click, but a second one pops up. And the question appears. Two bodies have I, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run.
Ah, fuck. This sounds familiar, but I completely forgot about it.
Two bodies I have, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run. I can repeat
two
it.
Bodies.
Would you let me repeat it once more?
Yes.
Two bodies I have, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run.
God damn, we forgot about this one.
This sounds familiar. Was this in Elder Scrolls Online?
I don't know. I've never played it.
I think it's in Elder Scrolls Online.
Sure. I will tell you, these are all D&D riddles. I have pulled these all from books.
I think I've heard this from...
What edition? I'm not saying, though.
3.5. $5 is going to be 3.5.
What was the answer?
Would you like to use that as the as your exchange
no,
for the
Okay.
The answer, it's 3.5.
Elder Scrolls Online.
It's right. Oh, my gosh.
What? Dude, no. Come on.
No, I remember the thing. I remember the name of the...
You're looking it up, bro.
Looks it up quietly.
Can you say it again?
Yep.
Man, I used to like riddles so much.
Until the DM used them.
I had a huge, like, riddle phase that lasted like a solid week.
Two bodies I have, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run.
What goes fast when it stands? Nothing can go fast when it stands.
Like, yeah, that's the point of the riddle.
And you can also just decide to give up if you don't want to answer it.
No, I don't. We don't want to give up.
Wolf drives off in anger.
He comes to your house, punches you in the face.
I mean, honestly, you could just show up and look at my notes right now. But oh, I know where he is. He's too far away to get here quickly.
No. But if I can't save our party, I can be damn sure I'll avenge it.
So, can you repeat it again?
How many other riddles do we need to go through before?
This seems to be the last one from what you can tell.
And how many times can we still fuck it up?
None. Two bodies have I, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run. I just realized the person had a spelling error and put I have, and I was like, wait, that doesn't sound right, doesn't rhyme.
It is from Elder Scrolls Online. The answer is...
He googled it.
No, I remember it.
Do you?
No, I don't.
Alright, boys, I need an answer.
Hourglass.
Is that your final answer?
Yes.
Oh. What was it again?
The
two
riddle?
Bodies have I.
Two bodies have I, though both joined in one. The more still I stand, the quicker I run.
Oh, it does sound like Hourglass.
I mean, yeah.
Is it right? Did I remember?
As you shout out Hourglass, the statue cracks and breaks, and two creatures stand before you. One is a familiar face holding his chest. The other seems to be a giant amalgamation of what can only be described as a creature in a very weird and unique outfit, with red eyes like a cat, somewhat pointed teeth, and short, spiky silver hair. They seem to mix between the different races every few seconds, and you're not 100% sure what exactly it is.
You fuck it up.
You're not sure.
I guess.
And as you do this, the circle in the center of the room opens completely. However, as the circle opens and the ladder is exposed, the four creatures now walk up to, or seem to be unparalyzed, and we roll initiative.
Zima, important question.
Yeah.
Do you have Featherfall?
Let's see. Do I? I don't think I do. Maybe I do. Featherfall.
First spell. First level.
First level? No.
Shit.
I have Ray of Frost.
All right. Would you like a second to plan out your strategy while I
Nope. So can you kind of give us what's this? There's four things in the center of this circle.
No, they were standing in front of their statues and have started moving after you lot.
Okay, are they all in the same area?
No. The what looks to be Greed was standing in front of his statue with the monster beside him, and the one known as the Pious One is standing in front of his own statue with the Weeping Angel.
I see.
So who did we fuck up first?
Let's see. These things are statues?
Nope. They look to be people.
Oh, they're people.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Cool. All
right. Let's get it. Let's roll. All right. 13 for your Gar.
That's a 20.
Okay. Zima with a 20.
I got a 18.
Okay. And then Houdini with an 18. And let me roll for Felizar. That's a 16 since he has a minus 1. Oh, gotta love Felizar.
I assume Yorgar's a physical character, right?
You can, yeah.
You don't know.
I mean, that's...
Yeah, probably.
I mean, he looks muscular.
He's a big dude.
Well muscled. He has
and
no
he has weight. So he should be strong enough to use weight.
Super well muscled, but, yeah, no weapons, no shield, just the half plate armor.
Would you like to be enlarged? I ask him.
Yes.
Got Big it.
Emphasized yes.
Definitely. Uh huh. It's the best fates of all. All right, give me a minute. I'm just loading up something real quick. Because I've got to get something going here. The DM may have forgotten to give gear to certain things that he was supposed to be doing and doesn't want to screw this up. Because he forgot something in the middle of making breakfast for dinner. Okay. Yeah, that works. Okay. And, okay.
Hello.
Is it me you're looking for?
No. I'll be honest. All right. 2 seconds, guys. I'm going to get everything going. As I'm also trying to pull up something else at the same time that's not loading very fast. So, yes, Hourglass was, by the way, the answer for that riddle. And yes, you are right. That is from Elder Scrolls.
Wow, so he just decided to fuck us over. Got it.
Nope. It wouldn't have mattered if you got it right or not. The
so
second one was a trap. Yep. Well, I mean, you're not wrong.
So there's two people.
Mm-hmm. And two
characters.
Yes.
And two what?
And two monsters.
Oh. They're all far away from each other.
Semi, yes.
Ooh, how far?
If you had to guess, a rough estimate is about 25 feet overall.
25 feet.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, and then one last thing. Wait, okay, give me a minute. I'm just pulling up one last portion.
Are they're all, like...
Coming at you.
Okay. I think I'll just...
And if the DM can find what he's looking for, that would really help.
Are there any
spellcasters? You excited the weeb, Fraz. Why'd you do this?
What?
Fraz excited the weeb.
Nothing. It doesn't.
Doesn't matter. Game.
Okay. Should I be concerned slightly here? Like.
No.
Okay. All right. And then one last thing. Where is it? Okay. All right. And boom. Okay. So, as the creatures start to come towards you... wrong dice. Oh, fuck me. Okay, and... let me add that. Okay, getting initiative order down, because the DM is totally not late to the party here, as he was trying to figure out something on command, which he's bad at. All right, and then okay. Okay, there's the initiative order. For those wondering, all right, let us begin as they start to charge for you, towards you. Zima, you are up first. As I said, there's 25 feet in between Reed and the Pious One, as they are two separate parties as of current as they are charging towards you. However, both of them have a monster beside them that is mirroring them.
So they're both within 25 feet of each other, and they both have a monster right next to them.
Correct.
They're both within cum shot range.
Oh. That explains the shark head.
Let's see. We got two options here.
Mm-hmm.
Fireball or wall of fire? Fireball.
If you do wall of fire, I'm singing it.
Wall of fire, because that could actually...
Right, because they're both 25 feet away from each other, right?
Yeah.
Then fireball wouldn't hit. Okay, I'll do a wall of fire.
All right, as
and
you
it's going to be facing towards them, so that way if they walk to us, then they get damaged.
Okay, do you do it while singing "Love Is a Burning Fire"?
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
well, that's why I was humming it like a couple minutes. Why I was humming it a minute ago.
As the firewall grows an inch extra foot in height, as he sings the song, casting it. Okay. So you're putting it in between. Yes.
Are we in, like, bright light? Or
yes.
Are we in, like,
bright light.
Now we are.
Yes, the room is brightly lit.
Gotcha.
As the torches, as the sconces are still lit. Alright, now are you putting the firewall right on them? Or wall of fire?
Not right on them, like, in front of them.
Okay, so blocking you guys.
When you walk, basically, it blocks them from getting to us, but we can go still get to them.
Okay.
I mean, they can still come to us if they want to take damage. It's 5d8 fire damage. Just
okay.
Saying.
All right. I'm just reading something real quick to make sure I'm correct on this. All right. So as you put this wall of fire, now none of you can see the people on the other side, except you can see the giant greed monster that literally towers over this wall. It's large.
That's what she said.
Well, it's 15 feet tall. Okay. As you do so, and is that going to be your only action, Zima?
I'm going to move.
Okay. As you start to slowly back up, I assume behind Yorgar and Falazar to let them take point.
Mm-hmm.
Your new meatball. All right. The walls erupt from, or the firewall erupts from the ground, spouting out as Zima slowly backs up, singing "Wall of Fire" or "Ring of Fire." "Wall of Fire" is his new rendition. It's the newest bardic hit on the airways. It's part of the top 100 singles. Just like Zima.
Ouch.
Ranked 48th. All right.
What makes him the 48th?
Good question. Houdini, what would you like to do?
I'm just gonna cast Enlarge.
On...
Not just cast Enlarge. I'm going to use it as a twin spell.
Oh. Ooh. All right. So you're double enlarging him?
No, I'm not double enlarging. I target two people.
All right, and you're gonna enlarge in both Falazar and
Yorgar, yeah.
Okay. So you.
And as a bonus action, I am going to give Yorgar, what's it called again? The dice that bards.
Inspiration.
Bardic inspiration. Yeah.
Yep.
It's a 1d6, by the way.
Okay.
Sweet.
All
I'm
right.
I'm just gonna go behind them.
And you're gonna back up as well. Okay. Now you two have full frontal view. As you start to back up and the two men in front of you get larger, the Hezra a little shocked by the suddenly enlargement of its master. Reed suddenly begins to... You hear him groaning and grinding on something. And as you start to hear this loud noise, the wall of flame... turns immediately into a wall of ice.
Okay.
Same height, same thickness, completely dissipating the spell.
That's bullshit.
Alright.
I mean, they still have a wall.
Yes, that's true.
Do you guys just want to climb down real quick?
We got time.
So, next up is Falzar. Do you want him to start heading towards the circle and climbing down?
No, Falzar is going to pick up Trent, whatever his name is.
Zima?
Yeah, and then walk down, like...
Climb over more to the ladder? It's a ladder.
How low does it go?
You can't see the bottom, it's a pitch black hole.
Then he's gonna, like,
cast light.
You can't cast on your... not your turn.
Yeah, it's not your turn.
He's gonna fireman carry you? Okay.
Ladder.
I'm humming Wall of Fire.
Well, it's a nice now, but go off. Yeah. I guess.
Alright, well, that was an interesting roll. God, I forgot he had a -1 to his dexterity. So, as Falasar runs over to the hole, gets on the ladder, holding on to Zima. He starts to slide, and Zima, as you're enjoying singing your song, Falzar is just completely entranced with your song. Not realizing that, and not paying attention, his sweaty hand from the wall of fire that was there just a second ago loses its grip, and you guys go plummeting towards the ground.
Why don't I have Featherfall?
That's a question.
We're going to come back to you in a minute. All right. Yorgar, you hear the screams of Falzar and Zima as you don't know what's going on as they disappear into the darkness of that hole that's a few feet in front of you.
Alright.
Do the same thing.
Yeah, Falzar,
Yorgar.
Yorgar.
Mm-hmm.
Is going to, it's going to twitch and shake for a second.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to grow like a foot taller, and just patches of hair start sprouting out and covering his body, and he's a werebear.
Oh shit. Alright.
And he
still has his intelligence, right? He still has his intelligence.
Yeah. Going to he's just gonna pick up Houdini and fireman slide down the ladder, but actually do it well.
Okay. All right. As you rush towards the hole, give me a dexterity saving throw.
Not bad.
You can't do worse than poor Zima and Falzar right now.
Rolled a 1 twice, probably.
No, he rolled a 2 twice, but he has a -1 to his dex.
That's 9 natural 1.
Mm-hmm. Yes, Yorgar, what was that?
15.
As you start to slide down, you're sliding down for about 3 rounds of combat. So that's 30 seconds. That's a minute 30. As you guys are sliding down this thing, you hear the groans and scratches of an ice wall. And then you hear what sounds like the battle between a screeching demon and a screeching demon. Oh. As the two start attacking each other. And then as you're continuing down, you hear a loud plop as you see what looks to be a severed head of a giant lizard falling down the hole behind you, and it suddenly hits the ground in a loud squish. I will mention,
land on them.
Well, that's where I was about to get to. Zima, roll a dex save.
Sweet.
Burn. Listen, if you guys stop, I can just see me do it. Maybe it'll be fine.
5. Alright, that is 9 plus 3?
12.
Okay, that.
Okay. So as you finally land, give me a second. That is okay. So that's 5 of these. Give me a second. Oh, Jesus. 1, 5, 11, 12, 16. So you take 8 points of damage, Zima. Falazar takes not only the full...
How heavy is this thing?
No, it's... This thing hasn't hit you yet. This is you landing on Falazar.
On Falazar.
Yeah. Falazar takes the 16 doubled. That's 20... 32. 32 points of damage as he lands, fails his dex save, and has you land on top of him.
He'll live.
Well, let's do that again. That's 4, 8... 5 is 13, 16, and 17 points of damage. As he takes another 17 points of damage, as the head of his steed lands on his back, as Zima rolls out of the way. I know how it works. I'm using this on purpose.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I am. DM rules.
Yeah, but actually...
Yes, I know how the actual rules. For those who are wondering, typically when you do summon steed, if it dies, it disappears. But the DM is, since the DM gave Falazar special treatment to allow him to summon a demon, fiend, technically.
Which he didn't ask for.
He did, actually. He asked for a fiend or a celestial being.
Creature type, that's fiend. It's a creature type.
Yeah, well, still works. Yes, the head flops on, hits him, and then vanishes. This poor Falazar takes more damage, going and just kind of getting up and groaning at the pain. On what?
On what?
I want to stop it from falling on him.
You're too late. I already rolled the damage. Goddamn, wow, that was delayed, Tren. And he's the smart character of the group. That's the funniest part. He's the smartest one of you all. Unless Yorgar is secretly a scholar.
I'm just here for the memes.
Which you really should. Okay. Yeah, so as you guys, as you finally land Yorgar on the ground and start to look around, the sconces around the room slumberingly light up, and all you see is, again, another giant circle of a room.
God damn it,
and a giant mirror.
Okay.
That's it. And the above ladder seems to seal off.
Looks like we're going to have oxygen deprivation, boys.
Oh no, there you can feel a nice wind hitting you, coming from the mirror's direction.
Oh goddamn, it's a dimensional mirror. Quick, someone poke it.
Poke the thing!
Chuck the head into the mirror, lightly.
It's disappeared, as I mentioned.
Right. Alright, is Falzer still alive?
Oh yeah, Falzar's hurting really bad, but he's alive.
Is he dead? Is he almost dead?
No. He looks rather bruised and beaten. He won't be much use to fight past about 2 to 3 rounds, but, you know.
He's a paladin, right?
Yes.
He's going to use his lay on hands on himself.
Someone knows paladins. Alright, so that's...
I know everything,
jackass. Oh. Alright.
So that's 5 times his level. Might as well use everything.
Yep, so...
Pump in as much as he needs. We don't
maybe you leave 5 in case someone gets a debuff?
Sure.
Everything minus 5. Okay.
Okay, so he gives himself back 35 HP. Alright. Giving him almost to the top, but he's keeping about 5 of it just in case. Alright. And as you lot are looking about, the room seems empty. There's nothing in here. There's no statues. The pillars are very simple. The room is dark, relatively, compared to the sconces on the wall that are lit. It's simple brick of some sort of gray mortar. And there's no smell in the air. It almost smells like it's been there's no one been here for years.
I think the smell of stone.
Well, whenever someone says the smell of stone, I tend to chuckle at that, but sure, let's go with that.
Yeah, I guess we should just walk up to the mirror.
No investigation, arcana, or anything that anybody wants to try and roll on this thing?
What? I mean, we can just walk towards it.
Investigation right now.
All right, as you walk up to it, I'll take an investigation, arcana, or history check.
Investigation, arcana, and history.
I'll take one from any of the players.
Wait, so it's going to be one roll from...
No, I'm saying each player can get one roll if they want, but you can't roll all three.
Investigation, arcana, or...
Or history.
Okay. What? I'm guessing you have a high investigation.
No, you have a higher one.
Well, yeah, but I have a higher history than you, so if you have a high investigation, then you can just do the investigation.
I have plus 5 to everything. Every single one of those.
Yo,
so
I'm just looking at Falzar like,
bruh,
I don't know.
Falzar nods and immediately shrugs.
Okay, I'll do history, you do investigation, okay?
Wait, no, I got you. One sec. Falzar walks up to the mirror, glares at it. The mirror does nothing.
Oh, it's a perception check.
No,
I got it.
He failed an intimidation check on the mirror.
Oh.
That was the best thing. That's the thing he's best at, is intimidating.
Alright, okay. So... I'm history. I'm investigation.
Yep. So that's a...
Looks to your guard.
12 plus 11.
Alright, 12 plus 11. 23 in what?
18 plus 5.
18 plus 5, so... 23.
You doing, Jen?
2 23s. Zima, what'd you roll in?
History.
History, Houdini?
Investigation.
Alright, history. You recognize this mirror. This is a mirror that is supposed to, from what you remember, recall from the books many books you read in your time of college, stating most of this out loud as you're starting to monologue your own villainous speech. So that way Yorgar and poor Falzar kept up on this whole thing while they're completely confused that they can't intimidate the damn thing. you begin to monologue stating that this was a mirror designed by the ancient tieflings to travel from place to place. It was a simple dimension jump. However, in some rare cases, similar to the one like that you're looking at right now, which is a lot larger, they can be to their own personal realm or domain or location, in which sometimes people would seal themselves away in or seal items of importance in. And only people with the understanding of what the magic word is to activate it can get through it. You recall that the word can be found typically somewhere on the mirror, but it's rather hard to locate due to the fact that these mirrors are designed by the person who wants to use them. Many a times that these things have been used or activated have been by liches, or to find and slay grand liches of great power. Most commonly, you remember hearing a story of a lich queen who used it to seal away her phylactery along with the blood of all the children she managed to kill and take the innocence of to, in spirit form, just to make that very clear, stealing away their own energy to keep herself youthful looking and permanently mortal looking. With an investigation check, Houdini, looking around the mirror, you circle around it, realizing there's a back area to it. You see a crack in the back wall behind it that seems to go on into a further tunnel. And you also see a really rough carving in there that says, activate. In common. Carved into the back of the mirror.
Motherfucker. What the hell? Who made this? I'll shake his hand.
A dipshit. So me.
So, what's the correct word? Does the correct lead to?
You think that the correct word is activate. According to what Zima monologues about, that makes the most sense. Although you do realize that these things are supposed to be hidden, but you do question now who this belongs to.
Do it.
It could be a trap. I've heard of traps that are like... I've heard of traps that are like... Oh yeah, this is the magic word to get through. Psych. It's actually a thing that releases acid into the room when you die.
Climb halfway up the ladder. I'll say the word.
Okay, I'll climb halfway up the ladder.
Falazar readies his great axe and stands next to Yorgar.
Oh no, I'm not gonna push out.
I'm gonna puss out.
Zemo runs to the ladder, climbs up out the whole way.
Before Zemo's even, like, partway up the ladder, I'm gonna say activate.
As you say that, and Zemo cringes at waiting for the room to fill with acid. You look at the mirror, and it starts to almost... The mirror kind of liquidates in almost like a mercury-esque coloring. And... It starts to kind of bubble and move, but nothing seems to happen.
Hey, get back here.
Alright, I run back and I just jump through the portal.
You're supposed to be...
Alright, Zima, as you jump through, you land on the other side. Now, to the rest of you, all you see is he walks right through this thing like a thick liquid as it then kind of gives off a little ring of, repercussion
fire.
From the
ripple,
entrance.
Ripple.
Yeah, ripple, thank you. As you land on the other side, Zima, the room immediately lights up, all the sconces going up again, and you see in the center a simple jade throne with what looks to be a bearded skeleton with a Viking's helm sitting on a chair, holding a chest, and the chest seems to be having a light glowing out of it.
Skeleton alive.
Doesn't seem to move or react to you.
Huh. Okay.
Alright, we're gonna go in.
I cast Identify on this glowing chest.
Alright. And I assume Yorgar and Houdini are gonna follow through?
Yeah, I'm pretty stupid. I'm gonna walk through after him.
Falazar agrees and grabs onto Yorgar's shoulder to kind of guide him through and goes in. Smacking at it a little bit just to see the mirror, just to see if it'll do anything to his axe, and nothing happens. As you guys kind of climb through, you see Zima walking up to. Now, is Identify something you have to do is touch on?
Identify is touch, yes.
So you're going to walk up and touch the chest? Just to clarify? You don't sense any arcana on anything else in this room.
There's the only. Hand on the chest, and I want to bring it to me.
You want to bring the chest to you?
I just said not to fuck with the
So body. As you cast...
Fucking with the chest.
As you cast Mage Hand to pull it. Now, Mage Hand can pull how much weight?
It can pull...
10 pounds.
The chest doesn't budge and neither does the skeleton.
Huh.
Oh, it says don't fuck with the dead dude on the chest. So the chest is fine, question mark?
I think the dead dude's just a dead dude.
Yeah, but don't fuck with the dead dude. Reed said not to fuck with the dead dude, and they're not gonna fuck with the dead dude.
He said not to fuck with the dead dude?
Alright, Yorgar, with your amazing perception, and being the genius of the group, you find on the ground, off towards next to the mirror, right next to your foot, really, as you step on it, thinking it's just a piece of useless parchment that you don't care about. You pick it up, and you see it's actually a fully drawn artistic piece, and it's very beautifully made. I mean, compared to the stuff you've seen in your time with the Order of the Owl, this is a gorgeous piece, very detailed. Seems to be what looks to be a young woman of what looks to be a mix of Goliath and human. Very beautiful brown short hair, brown eyes, smiling as she seems to be looking towards the other half of the paper or the picture that seems to be torn off at some point.
Oh. Yeah.
Yes.
I just realized something. I want to look at the pelvis of the skeleton.
You can't see it. It's behind the chest.
God damn it.
Unless you're gonna the way the skeleton's sitting, it's the you won't be able to see the pelvis on its own.
Even if I like move around.
I mean,
not like push it or anything.
Technically, if you get to the side, you might be able to see it a little bit to get a general idea of it. Although it does, as you look, it does look a bit crushed. What are you looking for?
I just want to see if it's larger.
It's larger. It looks like it's a man's. It's wider.
Wow.
It's definitely wider. It looks like it matches.
If it's larger, then it's a
woman. It looks like it's it matches the person's build. As you're looking at the skeleton overall, getting a better look of them, they seem to have at one time been a very broad person. Like, shoulders are very far out, and they seem to be a little bit of a wider skeleton.
Yeah, That's okay. A man then.
Yes, Jorgar, you're looking, as you look at this picture though, yes, this looks like it'd be like a mix between a human and a Goliath woman, who's smiling and staring up at someone else on the other side of what would have been the picture that is now missing. Nothing else is in the room though.
Is there anything in the wall?
Nothing. The walls are simple brick.
Everything just a chest.
Nothing else in this room besides the jade throne that the skeleton sits on and the skeleton holding the chest is at all remarkable.
Investigation on the chest?
Sure. You're not going to touch the chest to cast Identify?
He's psyching you out, man.
Yeah, I'll do it. Identify. Fuck it.
So you walk up, touch the chest?
Yep. Yes.
Okay. As... God, I need more d20s these days. I need to buy some more dice. Alright, and then let me get the rest of this done. One sec. Jesus.
How many fucking d20s are there?
Alright. You're about to find out. As you do this, the chest starts to... bright light suddenly streaks from it, and you all hear a loud shriek come from it as it screams out in the shrillest scream you've ever heard in your life, causing you to many of you to drop to the ground holding your ears in pain as this chest continues its screeching, giving off even more and more magical presence, even to the point where even those who aren't capable of understanding the concept of Arcana can feel the presence of mana as they start to see glowing black lights.
Counterspell.
It doesn't seem to be a spell. Popping up. As you cast Identify and touch it, though, you also start to hear the screech in your head, Zima. First off, let me explain the item. And I assume you just want me to explain it out loud rather than telling you personally.
Just explain it out loud.
This is called the Chest of Greed. This is an item that is considered of artifact ranking. This is a godly item, a godly tier item. And it is supposed to cause a person who uses it and wields it great fortune and great... I'm looking for the right word here. Let's go with misfortune for the time being. This chest is said to grant the person who wields it and uses it in battle to be able to convince all those around them to give them all of their wealth, anything they consider of value, whether it be sentimental or monetary. From flesh to coin to items of themselves. It also causes the person who wields it to gain in strength equal to whatever opponent they take on, no matter the opponent. I.e., if they take on an ancient vortex black dragon that has a CR or has a strength of 30, they will suddenly become a strength of 30, even if they were not of that strength beforehand. They will be given all the abilities to kill any beast that they decide to do battle with. However, the curse that comes with this item is it causes you to continuously seek out more glory and more fortune, never allowing you to seek peace in any way. This item's history, as you found out, was wielded by the one known as Reed, the lost hero, the first hero, and the leader of the Church of Adventurers. This item would cause the poor grand hero to seek ever more fights and battles as you recall the stories of the adventurers and how each of them joined on to the party as the first hero would fail at first, but then continue on to defeat the creature he was sent on a quest to until he challenged all six of the Six Sigma Dragons, which are known to be beasts comparable to the Three Pillars themselves in ability and strength.
Question.
Yes.
Where's the lizard?
There is no lizard.
Well, Reed said there was a lizard.
The Hezrau?
No, the lizard that talks, like Reed said.
You haven't found one yet. That's a good question. As you continue to recall the entire information, apparently Reed had found great fortune throughout his life, continuously slaying beasts with his party, until one day he would fall for a woman. No one knows who this woman was. Some believe it was one of the women, or one of the female goddesses of the Church of Ability that he would fall for.
Should have got a bit Sasha.
He would fall in great into love with her and travel with her for a time, supposedly having some of the grandest adventures, even leaving his adventuring party for a time. But time would tell, and the curse Most would continue to fester, and eventually Reed would be forced by the chest to seek out greater fortune, and instead of seeing the world with his wife and loved one and most cherished one, he would decide instead to go on to take every city for what they were worth, until one day he would kill an entire village, as they thought that their potato farm was what was of value, as they showed up with bags of potatoes, fooling Reed into thinking it was nothing but gold coin. This would anger him and cause him to wipe out the entire city one by one, slaughtering both the children, women, and men in the most gruesome of fashions. As this would continue, his loved one, his wife, and the most cherished person of all would try to stop him before he went on this rampage, but barely missed the attack that would have that almost cut the city in half. She would decide to leave him at that point, and this chest of greed would continue to cause him to fester with more and more need for greed, until one day he would even slay the old gods who used to live in this temple, long forgotten to history. He would cut them all down one by one and take their power and wealth, until he found this mirror and would walk through it. This chest would cause him to seek even more power, but still yet there was none. At this point, he had gained all the power he could, and thus he decided instead that he would claim it and sit here for until another adventuring party arrived to kill. As the last portion of this tale goes, he would eventually find that picture to fall out of his pocket, the one that Yorgar now holds. And it is said that this chest would cause him to go mad. However, as the true tale comes forth to your mind, as you see the actual what happened, Reed would decide to instead empty the chest, giving up everything he had, all the fortune he'd found, billions of gold coins, items of legend and history, even the god-killing sword itself that now the Grand Pope holds. Callback for that one. for those who forgot. And, however, upon doing this, a monster would be unleashed from this thing. A monster that would look just like him, but with the power of greed, the sin of greed itself, that had gained more and more power as these gold pieces and items would be put inside of it.
Oh, it for would... fuck's sake.
Would you like me to finish, or would you...
Yes.
Alright. As the two did battle, as he tried to retreat through the mirror and escape, eventually he realized that if this creature was allowed to escape, it would ruin the world. He decided to instead seal it inside the chest itself. However, upon doing so, as he closed the chest and sealed this great monstrosity inside, he would find himself crushed beneath it and too wounded to get away. And there he lies, forever holding that chest closed, cursed with the fact that he will never see the one he cherishes again, and living on in the memory that he lost everything, but that he still holds the world in his hands. Should this chest ever open, greed would swallow the world.
Except, yeah, greed got out now.
Wait, we didn't open the chest, did we?
We didn't, but we saw this dude.
You did see Reed. You saw Reed carrying a chest at one time with Mugu walking about, and then you saw him again at as the statue of him broke as you screwed up the question, and you saw a monstrosity beside him.
Well, the world's fucked. That's nice.
However, Zima, since you're the one who touched it, you hear the screech to open the chest. You feel the power and presence of something inside, something that would give you everlasting wealth, more knowledge than you could ever expect to be able to consume in a lifetime. The books and tales of ancient heroes and villains that you so cherish, you can feel are inside this chest.
Are we still hearing the screech?
Yes, the rest of you continue to hear the screech. However, it does slowly die down. But Zima, you feel this, that this chest carries all of the knowledge you've ever sought. Everything you can dream of is within it. All you have to do is open it.
Can I just shout to Zima real quick?
Zima, give me a charisma saving throw.
Yeah, I have advantage on being charmed.
This is not a charm.
That is a charm. You're forcing me to do something.
This is not a charm.
This is a charm.
This is not a charm.
This is a charm.
This is not a charm. Listen to the DM and you'll know why. God damn, people. Trust the DM. Once in a while.
I don't.
I will ask when I don't know something. Don't worry.
Charisma saving throw?
Correct.
That would be an 18.
Alright. As this thing continues to talk to you, you realize it's bullshitting you completely. There's nothing inside of it. Except for this amalgamation. And lots of gold.
And lots of
gold. And items, but nothing that would personally interest you. No books that you can...
I wonder if touching it still would cause it to screech, so probably shouldn't. How the hell are we supposed to bring it back?
Remember, your quest was to find out what happened to the first hero. Not to bring the chest itself back.
Okay, so we're not gonna open it. That's a fact.
We did it, guys.
I want to get rid of this thing, though.
How the fuck are we supposed to get out?
Zima.
I want to get rid of this thing. This is no. This is not existing anymore. I want to Thanos snap this out of existence.
We do have a bag of devouring.
Okay.
Yeah.
That would probably open it. That no.
Yeah.
We're not doing that.
The creature would probably eat it and then...
Right, no,
but
I
then
wanna...
again, it just gets stuck in the bag.
Yeah, but it could be opened somehow. And we don't...
Yeah,
except
that's also
it
true.
Would be just in the belly of the creature. Like...
Or the creature would be inside the belly of Greed.
The chest would be inside the belly of the creature that ate it, that's in the bag of devouring.
Yes, that's correct.
Oh, so it's going to swallow it whole?
So,
yes. Yeah, there is a beast. So, there's always a beast when you open it on the other side that swallows
yeah,
the item.
I just meant that I would probably crunch it and destroy it. I was not hoping for that.
It's magical. It won't be crunched or destroyed.
Yeah, it can't be destroyed because it's magic. You can't destroy a magic item without using certain spells.
Oh, that's
okay,
true.
Okay, can I try... I don't have Dispel Magic,
you're
but
weak.
Can I...
I'm... No.
You're weak. Your guard walks up, shoves Zima into a wall, picks up chest.
I'm just gonna say to your guard real quick.
Mm-hmm.
I suggest for you to never open that chest, and I cast suggestion on him.
Okay.
Do you consent?
Yeah, I consent.
All right.
I'm also just gonna give him the bardic inspiration just in case he does fail.
Yorgar, go ahead and give me a strength check and then an athletics check.
Please do not break this thing. It's gonna
open
it up.
He can't break it.
I'm a werebear right now, so I have advantage on both.
Mm-hmm.
Which is good. That's so good.
Mm-hmm.
Strength.
Mm-hmm. For picking up the chest. 22, okay.
And athletics. That's shit. That's not 27.
Okay. Okay. All right. As you pick up the chest, you manage to barely yank it from the skeleton, who you realize had more must have had some really dense bones or something with it, because that was heavy. You barely made it past the requirement for that, as the skeleton's hand flops and literally dents into the throne.
And the
as you do this, Zima, you see a journal on, or what looks to be a leather-bound journal, at the side of the person laying there that you assume at this point is Reed. As Yorgar, as you pick it up, The chest is too much as it bursts open in your hands.
What?
So, I'll explain here in a second why that's the case. An amalgamation of what you can only imagine as greed, as this massive, demonic-looking creature with seven eyes, big blue horns, patches of fur and torn flesh of mixed coloration, stands towering over you.
Can I put the bag over the chest as it opens? God damn it.
Okay,
because it doesn't open, it shatters.
Magic items can't be broken. The magic item gets broken.
This thing, for those wondering, rolled a 16, but has a plus 13 to its strength saving throws, which, that you can do the math, that's a 29. As this
Would
thing...
Would you like to add the 1d6?
I would.
All right, I'll allow it, because I want to see you roll this. Because you rolled, what, 22, you said? 23?
27. Wait, is it the athletics or the strength?
It's the athletics.
27.
Yeah, 27.
Just roll it.
I want to do an assist action.
Nope.
Can I do that? Fuck.
Thank God I gave him Bardic Inspiration.
3.
Why can't I assist him?
All right, as you manage to hold the thing shut, two arms still manage to pop out of the damn thing, out of the keyhole, and start
shoot?
To try and attack you, Yorgar.
I can take it.
Yorgar, you're going to take two attacks, so
sure.
Just forewarning.
It's not.
Yeah, it is, unless you have something good.
Where, hold person?
Does not work.
No,
it has full spell immunity.
Excuse me?
This is literally a creature of cosmic design. This is to the sin of greed. Alright. It takes physical damage. Oh my fucking god, are you kidding me? Does a 19 hit?
It actually doesn't.
Oh, fuck you! God damn it! No! I'm burning this dice. There's a 20 hit.
Wait, let me check something.
I rolled a 1 and a 2. Fucking goddamn it.
Yeah, I guess I'm not.
Shouldn't he roll twice for fucking up the one?
So
I did.
That would hit.
That does hit? Okay, thank god. So the second one hits you. Alright, and then that is a... give me a moment. Oh, no, he's fine. Trust me, he couldn't do this. Where is my die? Okay, there it is. Or 30 points of damage.
Okay,
of bludgeoning damage. Also, do you have anything of interest on you?
I have my... armor
is your half plate.
Yeah, my half plate.
So as this
Wait,
happens,
did it disappear or is it part of you?
As this, no, it wouldn't. It would still be on him because with his werebear build. As this thing punches straight into you, Yorgar, it manages to pull with it your whole having a half plate into the keyhole, but its hands disappear.
Alright, open the bag.
Oh, I thought you were about to open the chest and go back for the item. I was like, oh shit, no. Like, damn, man, alright, you got some balls, because I'm about to tell you you're going to die. Alright.
It's already been opened.
So as you open up the bag... Alright, give me one final athletics check to see if you can manage to hold this thing as you're shoving it in.
Can I just give him another,
Fuck you, dice!
Inspiration?
Don't even bother, Yorgar! I rolled 2 natural ones.
So Greek killed itself.
No! It managed to seal its chest worth.
Those are your
I don't kill something on a skill check.
You
it
did.
Was... You absolutely
you do.
Let me explain what happens. Jeez, let the DM work, okay? Jesus. It's entertaining, all right? As the thing tries to seal open the chest, Yorgar, with his great prowess and werebear strength, clamps down even harder, managing to mangle the key lock closed to where the creature can't even put its hands out now. Forever sealing it permanently inside this chest. Thank you.
Oh.
Yes.
You don't even need to, I guess you want to carry it out.
Well, it could still theoretically... It could still theoretically break open the chest one day, but it can't reach its arms now out of the keyholes.
Oh, that's what
it
happened.
Can still be opened. Like, someone of Yorgar's strength could come in and just say, oh, here, an interesting chest. Let me crack it open.
All right, it's going to bag then.
And I'm only telling you this, even though as a DM I would find it funnier for you to leave it, as a player with common sense would realize this.
Yeah, I just assumed it.
Yeah, let's put it in the bag.
Yeah, it's going inside the belly.
As Yorgar shoves it into there, you hear a loud belch come from the other side.
You're welcome.
What happens if you cast... Actually, never mind.
Go ahead, finish your thought.
No, I was about to...
It's asking. You're not gonna do it.
Yeah, go ahead. Finish your thought.
No, I don't have it. Anyways, I was just wondering what happened. Would happen if you cast counterspell on a bag of devouring? I mean, not counterspell. I mean
dispel.
Dispel.
Afterwards, it just turns into a leather bag.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's high enough level. With an item like that, you'd have to cast it 7th or higher.
The chest would just disappear.
Yeah, permanently.
You just have to make an arcana.
No, I'm pretty sure the portal to do. Where the creature is, it's just gonna disappear, not the actual chest.
No, well, yes, that's what he means. It's gotta be forever sealed in that domain, either way. But yes, you wouldn't be able to reach back in there. Because with a bag of devouring, you can reach back in. You just have basically a certain amount of odds. I think it's 50-50. I can't recall.
50, yeah, it's
awesome. Of being able to pull it back out. If you used a dispel magic on it, or dispel spell on it, then when you put your hand into it, basically it's just a leather bag now. With a fancy drawing on it.
Well, whenever we get the chance, I'm gonna.
No.
You're gonna dispel that bag of devouring?
No, I need this for my magic trick.
The disappearing head.
It's like the pencil thing from the that Joker did that one time.
Oh god, yeah. Let me watch my pencil disappear as he smashes it into someone's skull. Yeah, so as you manage to shove it in there, the skeleton crumbles, and again appears the man with a lizard on his shoulder, smiling at you lot, holding a chest with a chain. And he looks to you lot and smiles even brighter and says, "One has gone, and another shall come. A new generation is born." And the lizard looks at you, smiles with a bright grin. Biggest grin you've ever seen on what is basically looks like a chameleon, and goes, "Verification.
Activate."
Activation.
Castration.
And with that, no! Zima suddenly feels lighter, and so does the rest of the party.
Whoa.
As you feel a very strong magical presence suddenly in the room. And the man looks at the lizard. I'm not joking. That actually does happen. I'm 100% serious. Do any of you have counterspell?
I have counterspell, you son of a bitch.
You're about to be attacked by
the lizard casts again.
Would you like me to cast counterspell again?
Alright, how many counterspells do you lot have so I can get this count off?
Five. I have many counterspells.
You have 5? And Zima, let me see how many you have.
Okay, 1, 2. I already cast one, so I have 2 more? Yeah.
So in total, you have 7.
Yeah.
Hold on. What's the.
Cancel activation.
As you feel the balls come back, then disappear, then come back, Yorgar saying, shouting, "Cancel the activation, please, for the love of God." All right,
somebody's about to die.
1, 2, 3.
Shut up. Let's not say anything else.
So, as you continue to cast it, both Zima and Houdini, you are you run out of your counter spell. The lizard finally stops. He just kind of pats it on the head as you guys feel your balls grow back for the last time. And he goes, yeah, yeah, I learned that lesson the hard way the first time too. Don't worry.
What I...
No, you're out. You're completely out of your counterspell or your counterspell spell slot. So any spell slot that you could use to spell, cast counterspell, you are out of now. Wait, what, Yorgar?
Activate.
It looks at you and says, verification?
Decastration.
No, it's already canceled.
Amalgamation. And with that, Yorgar starts to turn. Yorgar's left arm turns into this massive pus ball of an arm. And look, you gain 5 strength, Yorgar, to your left arm.
Why not right? Wait, are you left-handed?
It doesn't matter. Now it's left. It's this massive pus ball. It's muscular, but it's filled with weird liquids that seem to glow almost in the dim light. And it says,
do it again. Do it again.
Oh my God.
Says confirmation.
Do it. Yes.
Everyone loses their balls suddenly. And it gives a slight thumbs up. Activation.
Decastration.
Mizna Nation. Reed just looks at the party and says, "What the hell?" Alright, I have fancy talk, but what the hell is wrong with you people? You got rid of the chest of greed. That is literally the most dangerous item on this planet. And yet, you managed...
Don't ask me.
He just kind of puts his ace in his hand and goes, okay. I'm taking the lizard. I'm thanking you for what you've done. That's up to the lizard, not to me. And he sets the lizard on the ground. He says, that thing protects this place. I wouldn't piss it off. I've seen how big it gets.
Activation, decastration.
Verification.
Confirmation.
Mummification. And Zima, you lose 20 HP as you find yourself completely dehydrated. And you are very gaunt now looking. And it looks to you and says, multiplication?
No.
Radio communication. Yeah. Suddenly you have message cast between each of you. You can now all talk to each other permanently through telepathy.
God, I hate
I've never had this much fun with a lizard in my life.
Refortification. And immediately all the walls build up stronger. And Reed just kind of nods his head and says, I'll talk to you outside of the temple
can
when you're done.
Can we have a pet? Can we have that as a pet?
It looks to you, it says, detoxification?
Yes.
Confirmation.
No. You're cautiously no. Zima, confirmation. Verification.
Big yes.
Desertification, and suddenly sand starts piling up in the room. It comes up to your knees and stops.
I climb up the sand.
Alright, as you climb up the sand, now you've got only 3 feet, or 4 feet above you now at this point that you can really comfortably go up to.
Jesus Christ.
Magnification? The lizard's continuing.
Can you restore my...
Falazar's on the ground. Gone. Like, out.
God damn it.
As you realize, he fell unconscious about halfway through that fight due to the poison damage he was taking from the Hezrau landing on him.
Oh, yeah. It was a poison.
Electrification! And the entire room lights up with electricity. Yorgar, your arm suddenly... Yorgar, your arm turns into its own little laser beam of electricity now as it can shoot out a 10d5 of damage of electricity.
Temptation.
What the fuck are you doing?
Temptation? Verification.
Verification.
Zima and Houdini, you are suddenly extremely attracted to each other.
No.
Plantation.
Zima is immune to charm, and so
doesn't matter. Swin Lizard is immensely powerful.
Plantation.
Lizard says, deportation, and you suddenly find yourself outside of the city, or outside of the temple, standing on the ground in the Aarakocran village, with a giant wall at the end of the beach.
Masturbation! I yell.
The lizard is now sitting on Zima's shoulder.
Yes!
You just wanna go fucking talk to Reed. Yeah, I'm just gonna go.
Reed is just sitting there watching you guys as you just peered out of nowhere now.
I have a best friend now. Look at my lizard.
I'm still with the lizard, right?
The lizard? No, all of you are on the beach now. On the Aarakocran village, and the lizard is sitting on Zima's shoulder currently. Just sitting there.
I love you.
And
I
there is now a gamblers. Massive...
I am with gamblers in this goddamn...
There is a massive 20-foot stone wall along the beach.
Glorification.
Verification.
Glorification.
Usurpation.
Medication. And immediately all of you are at full health.
Oh, nice.
Sweet. Vaccination.
Zima, you are suddenly sick with the plague. You take 20 points of damage.
God damn it.
And you now have little black pus balls all over your body. This lizard is the most entertaining thing of this entire one shot, I have a feeling.
Honestly, yeah.
just have Belzer cast restoration on you with his 5.
And yeah, the lizard kind of curls up onto Zima's shoulders and says nestification, and a little nest wraps around it, and it falls asleep. I'm on there actually right now. That's how I'm using these words.
Yeah. No, I'm on there too.
Oh man,
I just found one. Ejaculation.
Oh, I thought you were gonna say mastication. Yeah, so as you guys are sitting there, Reed just looks at you and says, so I'm going to be honest. I'm not going to use fancy talk because that poor lizard's kind of run the thing dry. This is only the beginning of what you're looking for. That journal that is, and he points to the pus ball that is now Zima, is only halfway filled out. The temple down in the Tabaxi lands is correct. The other temple you're looking for is in the Tiefling lands. To permanently get rid of that greed, the chest of greed, you must break all three of them.
But chests aren't breakable since they're magical items.
He looks to Houdini and says, I will wake up that fucking lizard.
Okay, shutting up now.
Thank you.
I praise the sun and say, illumination!
Zima, you are now... The lizard kind of groans, and you are now a bright light bulb to the point where your eyes are literally blinded by the light. You are now permanently blind.
Praise the sun!
The rest of the party, you don't see this.
Like we can't see him, or we don't
yeah,
see...
No, you don't see any of the light.
Pet the little lizard buddy, and I'm gonna say... Teleportation.
Damn it.
Verification.
Denied.
Yes. What? No. Activate. Do
denied.
It.
Confirmation of location.
Temple
Dragon Gate. Dragon Gate.
What was that, Yorgar?
Tabaxi Temple of Greed.
Confirmation. It nods off as you guys suddenly find yourselves literally in the middle of the king's court and the Tabaxi lands. The king and his 7 concubines are sitting in the room. He is in the middle of jostling one of them, as we'll use the kinder term. And he just, in surprise, jumps up. This massive man, that's about Yorgar's size, looks at you. And we will come back next session to deal with this.
Identification.
Thank you all for those who have watched. I hope you've enjoyed. We will come back next time to find out what other vacations this group can get up to.
Rectal fixations.
In this situation, that's so much worse than it really could be.
Exactly.
Thank you all for watching. I hope you've enjoyed. I will see you next time on D&D with the DM. I really don't have a good catchphrase for this. Someone give me a good catchphrase for this.
Nope. You dug your own hole here.
D&D with the Silent Guard and the Crimson Talon Guild with the Broken Null. God, that's too long. I'll come up with a better catchphrase by the next game tomorrow, maybe. All right, confirmation of masturbation.